Greg Norman has his fingers crossed Australian golf won't suffer any further embarrassment at this week's Heineken Classic. The Shark says it will take us some time to get over the international damage caused by the Greens debacle at the recent Australian Open.
Greg Norman and some high-powered guests at the official opening of his latest golf course. The prospect of a round with the Shark, enough to make a couple of icemen sweat.
I'm a bit nervous about it, I must admit. I don't play a lot of golf, and to play with Greg Norman makes it probably 100 times more nerve-wracking than normal.
I haven't played for about 5 years, so I'm not much for golf.
Apart from a classic war cover drive, the captains needn't have worried.
And Andrew Johns hopes to be off the golf course and on the footy field this weekend. Rugby League's number one player plans to lead the Newcastle Knights at the World Sevens tournament. Johns is coming back from a series of problems that started when he broke bones in his back during last year's final series. He's also had an off-season groin surgery and stitches in his leg from a surfing accident, but he is desperate to play.
You know, I really enjoy the format of the Sevens. It's generally a good start of the year, good fun tournament, and I think for the Knights' point of view, the chance to win it, get a little bit of money in the bank would be nice for him.
Joey will make a decision on whether he'll play or not on Wednesday or Thursday.
Okay, let's move on now to the Newcastle Knights, and they haven't brought any players into their squad for 2003, but when you've got the sort of roster they have, you can afford to lose a couple of players and replace them with local juniors who are itching for a game, and that's exactly the scenario for the Newcastle Knights this year. No gains, the losses are John Morris, Billy Pooten, Jared O'Doherty, Julian Bailey, Clinton O'Brien and Anthony Turpu. So John Morris perhaps, and Billy Pooten especially, you know, considered to be the heart and the soul of the club in some ways?
Yeah, club captain Billy Pooten has left to go over and play in England. I think John Morris will be a loss for them because he was very versatile for them last year. He could play out in the wing and play in hooker. You mentioned in the introduction, Warren, about how they could replace players. One player they can't replace is Andrew Johns.
Yep, no doubt about that. I mean, without Andrew Johns on the field, we've seen what happens. We'll take a look in a moment at the stats, but it's not a pretty story for the Knights.
No, it certainly isn't. But he's got some pretty good help around him, Andrew Johns, hasn't he, with Davis and McDougall, who didn't play much in last year, Tahu, Gidley and Hughes. They've got some quality players. The position I think they might struggle in this year is front row. They haven't got the backup of Jared O'Doherty or Clinton O'Brien this year. Parsons and Perry and Adam Wool now. Now, if there's an injury to one of those blokes, they lose size on their bench. All of a sudden, they haven't got a front row to step up. But Andrew Johns is the key.
At the moment, Sean Rudder, we've slotted him into the position of 5-8 alongside Andrew Johns. But I think, Russ, before the season's out, we might see young Kurt Gidley perhaps cement that role for himself.
Good young player, Gidley. I think you're right. But we talk about the season. Their whole season depends on injuries. They've got a fairly good starting 15, maybe a 20-man squad. But they're hurting a little bit now. McDougall's going to come back this year after almost 18 months off. Ben Kennedy, he's just about 100% from his problems. They've also got Mark Hughes and Clint Newton, who have been all crooked during the off-season. I think they're going to struggle for depth. I think they are another side that will be battling to make the top four.
Well, they know they need a fully fit Andrew Johns at halfback if they're to win the comp. And here's what some of his teammates had to say about what he means to the team.
Obviously, Joey's our rudder and he steers us around. And there is that hoodoo that we can't win without Andrew. But and statistics don't lie, and that's right. And every year we want to go out and try and prove that we're a great team. And we have great supporters and great club behind us. It makes it a lot easier.
It's just a matter of, I suppose, the Joey aspect again. If he's not playing, we've got to win our games without him. And hopefully, you know, what we've seen through Kirk Gidley last year, he'll come in and take over that role if we have any hiccups with our number one man.
With Joey going out, I think most teams have sort of got one big player that everyone revolves around. But when that happens, you sort of just got to forget about it and get on with the game and that. But personally, like if I get a chance to get in there, I'm trying to give it the best shot.
He certainly will. You mentioned the Joey factor, Brandy. Here it is with him, of course, 34-8 over the last couple of seasons. Without him, it's a nightmare. 2-10.
As Danny Medeiros said, the Joey factor's there. Definitely, I think the players realise that, and stats don't lie.
It was interesting to read Michael Hagan's comments during the week, how he will look at resting Andrew Johns if the games are already won, instead of leaving his playmaker out there.
I think that's smart, yeah. Mm.
Well, we could see him sitting on the bench for the last 20 minutes of games if they're in front by quite a few points. We'll see what happens up there in Newcastle as the season progresses. Of course, Adam McDougall, of course, he'll be back in action at some stage early this year, hopefully.
Yeah, he's a tremendous player, isn't he, Adam McDougall? I mean, when he is fully fit, he's one of the most damaging ball runners in the competition, and I think everyone in the game hopes that he comes back from a knee reconstruction. He's had a lot of trouble with it, but it must have taken a long time to, well, long time for his rehabilitation.
Yeah, we heard from Kurt Gidley a moment ago there in our chat about Andrew Johns. Such a good player, and as I said, I wouldn't be surprised to see him cement the spot at 5-8 with Sean Runner perhaps being shuffled back to the bench at some stage and maybe even the first part of the season.
Look, some players, when they come into first grade, they're intimidated to play with great players, but this kid's not one of them. He wants to get his hands on the ball. He don't mind overriding, having the overriding call to get the football when he wants it. He's got good vision, he's got good footwork, and I expect him to be in that number six jersey at some stage for a long time for the
Knights. Yeah, look, Sean Rudder's a pretty solid player. He's not as flashy as what Kirk Gidley is, and I think, you know, if you've got a bloke out there that's really worrying the defence, it could take a little bit of pressure off Andrew Johns too. So Kirk Gidley, definitely to get the number six job at some time during the year.
This has been a Fox Sports production.
Matthew Johns has been a great player. He retired at the end of the year. Chief retired because of headaches. Matty Johns retired because of...
Well, you did.
Mark Carroll gave it to you. You
what
had
about
headaches.
The nine operations on my knee? Doesn't that count?
Newcastle blokes have got that'll nothing. Matty Johns actually retired because of heavy dandruff. He couldn't go on board the flakes. But he was a great player, of course, playing for Newcastle and finishing off with Cronulla. And here's some of his highlights.
Mate, I reckon before long, that could be the new Premiership trophy. Forget Summers and Praven.
I think it could
Harrigan,
be.
Harrigan, Johns.
I'm going to be carried away. Did it look all right, did it? The embrace. Exactly
looks like you're based from Newcastle. That's what
we got Gallagher. Is there any royalties in that? Will there be royalties
in that? No royalties in the show.
How good is this? Honestly, ever since I heard you were coming on the show all off season, couldn't wait for you to be here, mate. So congratulations. Hope you enjoy yourself. Give him another round of applause.
Well, I've always known it was a popular show. I just didn't know how many people watched it. I mean, since I've said, people have said I'm coming on the show, the hate mail's just rolled in. It's been great. It's been tremendous. But no, I'm really looking forward to working with you guys. But the season in general, I'm just looking forward to tomorrow night, big game. And this year, there's about eight teams can win the competition, so it'll be great.
All right. Well, welcome again to the show. Now, Trent's been around, of course. What we've done with Trent... We've sent Trent out to all the clubs, and you'll see this all through the year. Trent's just doing a bit of investigating, hanging around the clubs, and we've got our first instalment from Trent the Flight Steward.
Great to be back, guys. I'm just so excited. And you know why? Tomorrow night, 2003 NRL kickoff. The boys are saying goodbye to the beach umbrellas and suntan lotion. They're going to get down and get dirty. I'm going to whip around a few of the clubs to see how things are hanging.
We got Fella in a mono here. I must say, Fella, here we go, me. You had my dream, guy. To get paid to punch guys around the ring must have been a great feeling. Hey, look at those things.
These things, they got me in trouble with these things.
Oh. Well, it wasn't such a bad thing. You just got to be careful who you're doing it to, buddy.
Yeah. If you were playing, it would have been all right.
I would give you a man of the match. The Daniel Wagon here. Daniel. Oh, look at that. He's trying to tell me it's sauce. Related to my sister. She's a dyke. She's the only one in the family that likes girls, actually. Cracking safes. Never thought about doing that with that crack you're showing game. Because I tell you what, son, that's a combination I'd love to crack anytime. Hey, you like your haircut, buddy? You like the Beatles?
Yeah.
Hey, we do a Beatles song together. Baby, you can drive me hard. Boom, 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 boom. Yes, you look like Ringo Starr. An old teammate of mine, and I think at one time an old lover as well. Brian Smith. How's the season shaping up, mate?
Really well, mate. We're looking good. Well,
they are looking good, I'll give you that. Who's going to be the team to beat apart from the Snakes?
Probably the Roosters.
What are you doing with your hand, buddy?
I've been slacking after training, being a little bit lazy. So the Knights coach and staff asked me to come down here, come down hard, kick a little bit of ass. Time to get physical. You do much stretching before you run?
A little.
I'll see this. What you do is okay. Grab on. Get down. Two minutes. You start. I said, ah. You do that? Get down. I'm gonna stretch that groin. Yeah. Okay, give me that. No. Lay down. Oh, yeah. Yeah, just push that one. This one really, really gets in deep. Oh, I think. Oh, just that. Don't say nothing. Someone got a cigarette?
Good stuff.
Nice.
I'll tell you something, Fatty. Poor old Trent, he just hasn't been the same since last year with Jason Stevens, did we?
What are you doing?
Oh, he did everything. Absolutely everything. And he hasn't been the same.
Well, it's good to see Trent back and around, and he'll be causing havoc amongst the clubs, no doubt about that.
Yeah, I got it.
Well, last week the NRL and QantasLink organised some of the players to visit country towns and basically where they started their football career. It's a great concept. Now, thanks to Panasonic, they sent all the boys out with video cameras, and this is what they've sent back. Have a look at this.
Chief.
Yeah, the feature piece for this week is a great one. It's on Andrew Johns, and Tim Sheridan caught up with him in Newcastle and Merriweather, and basically just got his point of view for 2003, a few behind-the-scenes things, but he also took him for a surf. Have a look at this.
I'll go down those lefts. There's no one out either. It's a great release for me, just to get out there and get away from all the pressures of rugby league and life. So I don't know what I'd do without it. So, it definitely helps me footy.
If what Joey says is right, the Knights can rest easy. His form line stretches from the Burwood break to the Newcastle scrum base. Yet even the best can suffer opening day doubts.
Before each game, each trial match, every year, it's probably the most nervous I get. Your head's full of self-doubt. Can I still play well? Have I still got it? And to a degree this year, it's probably even more because
it's been 5 months since I've strapped them on, strapped the boots on. And, really nervous, really anxious. And I just want to get out there and tear in and, you know, get the peace of mind of my mind that I know that I'm right to go again.
They say a golf event isn't fair dinkum without Tiger Woods. And in the same sense, the NRL has its yardstick back in place, the man against whom all others are judged. But Joey's absence this time marks a turning point in the career of the game's busiest player.
Will you reduce your time on the field this year?
Yeah, definitely. Michael Hagan's, our coach, has talked to me about that. And if we do skip to a big lead, he's going to bring me off. And he sort of asked me about it, and I think, you know, it's fair in the long term of not only my career, but also the way the side plays. The confidence level, I think, goes down a little bit when I'm not there, so it'll help get the boys through that.
Less time on the field doesn't really suit his personality, though, does it?
No, I haven't been successful in, I think, dragging from the field in the 2 years that I've been here, but that's something that at least we've spoken about before time, and I haven't got anything in writing from him, but that's what we'll endeavour to do this year.
A broken back, ribs, and even various surfing wounds have all healed. But Joey's groin remains a problem, even after four operations.
It's just a chronic injury now. It's just going to be sort of hampering me for the rest of my career. It's just a part of managing my body that I can't be like a 20, 21-year-old and go out and do 10 400s anymore. I have to do it in the pool or do it on the rowing machine.
Fittingly, Joey's appearance launched this NRL season. He is literally everywhere, the game's hottest property, with his life story on DVD selling in the tens of thousands.
You've got to learn the basics, and me and Matthew playing in the backyard, whether we knew it or not, we're just, you know, probably learning all the basics. We grew up around football. Our father coached football, so we're always at training and that.
In public, the smile seems to be always asking about the party. Joey is the storybook larrikin living in the goldfish bowl at Newcastle. But for a 28-year-old newly single father, there's a lot of balls in the air at once.
Do you ever get down? Depressed?
Yeah, occasionally, yeah. Different things get me down.
Yeah, what sort of things?
Oh, just when footy's not going well. Other things, mainly when footy's not going well, and especially with the pressure, when the pressure gets too much, and then you sort of lock the door, stay indoors, or take off up the coast and get surfing and stuff.
The dearest is dummy half. John's on the right. John's kicking off that outside edge, and there it is again!
5 months off is long enough to think of some new tricks, and for Joey, last year's game has never been good enough. That's his view on State of Origin.
I was happy with the way I played the first game last year, but the second and third I probably didn't play to a level I'd like to, so that's probably the next thing for me, to play well at that level.
Forcing Joey to rest won't be as hard as teaching the Knights to win without him, but at some stage, both of these goals have to be achieved. Young Knights utility Kurt Gidley is a key to that. For now, the best is back. If this return is half as good as his most famous comeback against Brisbane 2 years ago, the Knights will soon forget what it was like without Joey.
Can you win it this year with the Knights?
Definitely. We've got to be consistent all year. And once we get to the semis, if we're in the semis and we've got everyone on board, it'll be really hard to hold out.
After the break on Boots and All, Chief Harrigan and Spud Carroll go head-to-head for one last time. Carroll, Harrigan goes in on top of him again!
On Boots and All, let's move on to one of my favourite memories from the 90s, and that was the clashes between Chief Harrigan and Mark Spud Carroll.
Yeah, look, at the time, it was one of the real features of the game. You had these two physical giants, very passionate about their football. When Spud and the Chief were on opposite sides, you knew they were going to rock the foundations.
I kind of distinctly remember, I think it was a city-country match at Wollongong, raining, that kind of the penny dropped that Spud was, it was a bit more personal instead of just being fired up for the game. I think he was pretty fired up to put a challenge to me, I think.
Probably when I got to Manly, 94. The games against Newcastle was that was probably the start of the rivalry back then. He was being number 10, I'd been number 10 for Manly, and the Chief was there, I always wanted to take him out.
Now Carroll again. Harrigan goes up the top and Muir underneath. Oh, Carroll. And there's a punch up. Carroll and Harrigan. It was predicted.
Sometimes the exchanges were so heated and the verbaling and the physical stuff, you know, you kind of lose your marbles a little bit. So at times there, it was a little bit sort of seek and destroy type of thing.
I always have a look at the calendar when we were playing Newcastle, so it was like a bit of a countdown for that game. But the whole week leading up, Bob Fulton, who's a guy who used to know how to make me turn on and used to always throw negatives saying, Chief's going to get you this week. I had that in the back of my mind. Terry Hill, Jeff Turby throwing negatives, and I got Mum and Dad ringing up. Dad ringing up saying, son, get the first shot in.
There they are. They come together. The two number 10, Harrigan and Carroll. Carroll then. Harrigan fired up. Let's go with the tackle.
I don't think we liked each other, and I didn't certainly like anyone from that Manly team in that era because, you know, it was just two opposite teams and towns.
Played very well the fullback too, Shannon Nevin. Difficult to come into the Manly side so late after his pulling out today and having the goalkeeping duties.
Oh! Harrigan has gone after Carroll!
He's in some trouble. He's gone. He's hasn't moved.
Harrigan!
And Carroll's got plenty to say. He's just got to back away, Carroll, and just say nothing.
What do you remember of that big clash in Newcastle in 1995? The collision.
Oh, the collision. Not much after it, by the way. I had a torn stomach muscle in my stomach. I went and got it needled before half time. Again, I got it needled and it just wasn't working. So the call was to come off because I was starting to lag around a little bit. And I said, well, hang on. They just scored another try against us. I said, we'll go for the kickoff because Spud, it's the usual routine. Someone else catches the ball for Spud, he charges onto it. I thought I'll just try and rattle his cage before I go. And unfortunately, I rattled my cage. But that's about what it was. And, you know, it was just one of those things where I tackled him with my head.
A lot of people don't know. If I didn't get up, my old man would jump the fence and kick me up the bum. That was his rules. You know? Always show you, you're not hurt, son, always get up. And I know it's hurting bad, but at the same time, Dave Gillespie's winding everyone up saying, Spud, give it this bloke. But the commentators at the time said, nah, there's nothing. You know, Spud's lost his cool, but all I did was get over the top and say, is that the best you can give me? But he was snoring, unfortunately, for Chief. But mate, that's the game we're playing. It's not tip footy. We're playing a pretty physical game. It's rugby league.
Now that it is all over, you're retired. Who do you think came out on top in the rivalry with Chief?
I think it was each way. I really do. No, it's mate, a couple of times he got me a beauty and I got him a couple of good times. So as long as we've turned out okay, and like I said, we can have a beer these days. There's no grudges there, but on the field we had our job to do, and yeah, we did it.
You know, it was one of those things where rivalry between big men up against each other is probably at the essence of rugby league, I suppose. You want that, you enjoy watching it, and it certainly brought the best out in me. So I don't think anyone really got on top. It was just an ongoing thing.
Great stuff there. Some of my favourite vision. Of course, Vossie, we should add that the two boys are really good mates
today.
Yeah,
good
today,
mates
but,
now, exactly.
But, I mean, have we seen... I don't think there's been a rivalry like that since.
No, we mightn't see another like it.
Matthew Johns putting the pressure on. Two teams for this year's grand final.
Well, Vossie, it's going to be a great season. It's one of those years. First for a long time, I reckon there could be six or seven teams could definitely win it. But I reckon grand final day, the new kids on the block, the young team, the Sharks, I reckon they're going to make their grand final appearance this year. And I think if the Knights... You know, they play to their ability and they stay relatively injury-free. I think they'll be there.
Mate, the Dogs and the Knights, I think. Dogs and the Knights, Joey field goal, minute to go, win the game. That'll do.
You've given us a lot.
Yeah.
Rugby League's two best halfbacks went head-to-head this afternoon across the Tasman. Andrew Johns leading the 2001 Premiers Newcastle and Stacey Jones calling the shots for last year's minor Premiers, the New Zealand Warriors.
Injury cutting his season short in 2002, with his first touch, the world's best, showing both his brilliance and that he's human.
Oh, he's just lost the football cold.
A penalty giving the Warriors first points and another kick giving John Carlaw their first try.
To kick in, they'll score. They get the bounce. Carlaw's over.
Stacey Jones going to the boot again for their second. Last year's grand finalists exposing a weakness in the Knights' defence out wide.
Was he onside? That's the only remaining question. He's gone in, put the ball down. Mander consults with the touch judge and points to the spot.
And when you're on a good thing, stick to it. Jones this time going for the banana kick. Henry Farfeely doing the rest.
Off the outside edge of the boot, the jump is on for Feely. He's over.
Andrew Johns giving Knights fans an anxious moment. And when the Warriors tried to attack his weakness, he wasn't happy. The home side had the chance to go 20-0 up, but in a turning point, the Knights were in at the other end in the very next set of six.
He's run through the gap and Simpson's in for Newcastle's first try.
And just before the break, the 16-0 scoreline was suddenly reduced to just a four-point margin.
Kennedy is over.
The Warriors scored first in the second half, but Newcastle just kept the tries coming to take it out 36-26 at full-time. Tahu with a double, Andrew Johns kicking six goals.
The Knights also have injury concerns. It's feared Ben Kennedy has a broken hand, while Matt Parsons has ruptured discs in his back after the win over the Warriors.
Some costly injury concerns after the first round of rugby league, but not for Newcastle. Ben Kennedy plans to play on despite a fractured wrist.
Battered and bruised too, the Newcastle Knights second rower Ben Kennedy breaking his wrist as they got out of jail against the Warriors.
Played with it in the test a couple of years ago, so maybe I might be able to do it again.
Prop Matt Parsons is also hoping he can avoid back surgery.
It'll be around 5 weeks if I have to. And that's worst case scenario too, to go and get it done. And
the Knights, with the world's best player in the side, did what a lot of us expected they would do. They won the game, particularly when the acid was applied to them towards the end of the game. And of course, Joey came up trumps. They're worth 8 out of 10 on that performance.
Rugby League is back for season 2003, and every Rugby League fan needs Big League magazine. Big League is the complete guide to what's happening in the Telstra Premiership. The best stories, the best columnists, the best stats, the best photos, official team lineups, and the chance to win fantastic prizes. If you're serious about your team, don't watch a game without Big League. In newsagents every Thursday, or get it at the game.
Now, Wayne Carey, the Australian cricket team, and Gordon Tallis have all been in the news this week, but here's what's making tomorrow's sporting headlines. In the Daily Telegraph, why Andrew Johns is passing on the secrets of his football magic.
This has been a Fox Sports production.
Tomorrow night, the Knights at home to the Roosters. Promised to be a wonderful game. The Knights, great win last week coming from behind. The Roosters, awesome in winning last week as well against Parramatta. You'll see it at 8:30 p.m. And let's have a look at the ins and outs. A couple of changes there. Of course, Ben Kennedy and big Matty Parsons, who played so well last week, are out. No changes for the Roosters. And I tip the Knights, but... yeah, I don't know. I've heard that maybe Craig Wing might play for the Roosters. He'd be a welcome addition to the side. How do you see it going, boys?
Look, I think it's going to be a close game. A couple of good clashes. Hodges and Tahu out there in the centres will be wonderful. But I think Morley had a wonderful game last week, very athletic. But the big one is how the Knights are going to combat the Roosters' defence. I don't think they're just going to go normally straight up and down. I think it's going to be an important part because you just can't get through this defence, Matty.
You know, the misconception is people think that the Roosters willy-nilly every time defend up and in. They don't. When you're on the field with them, they have two calls. If they're dominating the ruck area and they're defending on the front foot and they've got the ascendancy, they attack you with their defence. Yeah. If you're playing the ball quick and you're getting forward, they tend to hold it. And that's got to be the Knights' goal. Now, they've got to be playing the ball quick. They've got to be getting forward. Because if you don't, like Parramatta the other night, you're like you're playing in a phone box. There's just nowhere to go.
I'll tell you quickly, the other one too is Freddie Fittler, renowned for putting people through gaps. But now he's hitting holes. I think he's the best hole hitter in the game.
Yeah, perfect, he is at the moment.
Perfect.
Started line. Well the other night.
He used to be. But he really is. It's very dangerous. He's very good at it.
What worries me for the Knights is that they've only had 4 days to recover from a tough game against the Warriors. The Roosters have had a full 7 days to get
loss.
Over that.
Ben Kennedy, he's inspirational. Yep. No, he passed. They've got some good young kids coming through. The Roosters got a good record against them recently. I think it's a tough one for the home
What do you
side.
Reckon, Pete?
I might have tipped the Roosters on what I saw last week. Kennedy and Parsons out definitely swayed me.
G'day. I'm Red Dragon. And welcome to my new segment, You're in Strife. The concept of this is quite complicated, really. I'll try to explain it to you. Basically, this year, I'm going to catch up with past rugby league legends and get faced with them. Sounds great, doesn't it? Well, today I'm on Bris Vegas, and I'm catching up with just about my favourite bloke in the whole world. He doesn't know we're coming, so come on, let's go and surprise him. Let's have a look. It's just through here. Tommy Radonikis!
Geez, what are you doing here,
You're in strife.
Geez, you scared the out of me, fair dinkums.
Well, Tommy Radonikis, welcome to You're in Strife. Now, before we get started, just want to talk about the health, mate. They tell me you've got a little bit of gout.
Is that
true?
Yeah, mate. I had a bit of gout over the last couple of days, and actually, I got it after Australia Day.
Mate, what's it from? Too much fruit, too much seafood, or just too much piss?
Well, mate, I think it's a bit of everything. I think it's a rich living, and probably when you all boils down, I suppose it is the piss, mate.
Absolutely. Ooh. Tommy, I want to talk about your upbringing. Mate, as a kid, you must have been, I reckon you would have been a real tough little prick, am I right?
I was pretty tough. I was brought up in a migrant camp, see? And I remember one day, my mum was I was crying, and my dad came home from work, and he said, "What's the young baby crying? Have you changed his nappy?" She said, "I've done it 15 minutes ago, I changed his nappy." You know, and then I was crying for another half an hour, and you know what? Mum put the pin through the nappy and me skin. So here I was, mate, in all this pain. So that's where I think I got my toughness from.
Oh, I'm
seriously.
Sure. I'm sure you did. You're a tough bastard, Tommy. As a player, Tommy, you played with the West Magpies, your beloved Magpies, 201 games through the late 60s and 70s. Mate, they great days.
Those games against Manly, I know we had the face slapping and I know it was a bit violent, but I tell you what, if you put them games on now, you'd pack them out.
Boy, I loved you blokes. Was it you blokes loved to bash the shit out of blokes on the field and they even bash the shit out of each other before the games?
It is a word.
Well, I remember Tommy watching a game once and eight. You actually had the ball kicked off to you or something. You ran through the ball over your shoulder and just started punching the shit out of somebody.
No, I'll tell you what that occasion was.
Mark Murray, I remember once you just punching Mark Murray. He's never looked the same since. He was actually...
Yeah, but Reg, what you're doing here, so you're going on all this punching business. Yeah. I wasn't a bad footballer either.
Oh, hey, Tommy, you're a top liner.
No, I wasn't too bad,
top liner. Tommy...
But these blokes... They deserve what they got.
Who's your favourite players nowadays?
My favourite players nowadays, Alfie Langer, he just retired. Well, I coached Alfie and I still have a bit to do with him. Your brother is a fantastic player.
John Rogan.
John Rogan.
he plays lower grades.
Tarantulas, yeah.
Yeah, he plays lower grades for Tamora,
people who don't know. That's right,
good kid.
That's a good kid. But Andrew Johns, I like. Yeah. I like him.
Can't agree with you there, Tommy. Scared.
No, I like, mate. I do like him.
Love what you've done with the place, mate. Obviously in the fish business. What are you doing with yourself these days?
Selling fish, mate.
And also pippies, Tommy.
And also pippies, mate, yeah. Mate, I dug them up last night. You eat one, try one. You can eat them.
Eat it?
You can eat them. Come on, Reg, come on.
Jeez. Tommy.
There you go.
Yeah, pop a rib, mate.
In you go. Swallow him, come on.
Oh, beautiful, Tom.
What was that, eh? It was fresh. You were still alive, mate.
Tommy, thank you very much for being on You're in Strife. I think you're an absolute legend. And you've been a great role model for me and many other kids around Australia.
Thank you very much,
Tommy Radonikis, You're in Strife.
Yeah, we're out in the car park here of Channel 9, and good on you, Tommy, one of the greats, Tommy Radonikis there with Reg.
You go to a break, Pete. What have you got if you put four blokes in a pub, all got opinions, all they want to do is argue, two of them are Ray Warren and Ken Callender, I'll tell you what you got grumpy old men.
Or Johns? Now, there's a good subject. Who do you think was the best? Definitely.
Which Johns? Well, Les Johns or...
No, Andrew Johns.
Ray, if you sit on the fence, you get splinters in your ass. But on this particular occasion, I'm going to sit in the fence. They're both superstars, both champions. Andrew Johns would have been a champion in 1960 to 1965. And Johnny Rae would have been a champion in the year 2000. Andrew Johns is as good a footballer as anyone ever played the game.
He's the best, absolutely the best player running around the world today. Absolutely.
But you know what they like
and about... And Rae was the best player in his day.
The general public like them because they're knockabouts.
You've both been going, you make it three. So we're about to go into our third answer and nobody has said Raper or Johns.
OK, well, you
and you're talking about picket fences, splinters in your arse.
Ray, if you had to make a decision for your life, who's the best rugby league player you've ever seen?
I think Lewis.
Wally Lewis.
He's the only player I've ever seen dominate the game at the game's highest level.
Ray's favourite's Wally Lewis.
No, I didn't say it's my favourite. I said he's the best player I've seen dominate the game at the highest level. Therefore, I've got to put him there. I mean,
That's one of the more sensible things you've said.
If I was sucky,
one of the more sensible things you've said. You're a mate of Wally's, I know you are.
Hang on a moment. Sterling's probably my closest friend. Why wouldn't I say Sterling?
I thought I was.
I'm talking about amongst the footballers. You couldn't play netball.
Both men have been named best player in the world. Now two of league's greatest go head-to-head. Andrew Johns' Newcastle Knights take on Brad Fittler's Sydney Roosters. Nine's Friday Night Football, 8:30 Friday.
Mate, we won the grand final.
Mate, I thought it was a draw.
To this day, I thought it was a dead set draw.
Oh, there you go. Oh, mate, I didn't think I said that many times.
It ended up 1,500, didn't it?
By the end of the night, it was a few.
It was one of the great days for you, Blakes.
Friday Night Football's back on Nine.
Oh, my God, they've scored! That is magical stuff!
Book a seat in front of the box because current premiers, the Sydney Roosters, take on previous premiers, the Newcastle Knights. Big hits, big game.
Here's a try.
Premier versus Premier.
Yes, he'll score!
And if we haven't made our point, this is one huge Premier match.
He's over again!
Nine's Friday Night Football, 8:30 Friday.
In Friday Night Football, round two kicks off with the Roosters in Newcastle to face the Knights. The experts are split, trying to confidently tip the winner of a game featuring two of the game's great players.
Troubled by a groin injury this week, Andrew Johns has recovered for one of the games of the season. Newcastle's playmaker rescued the Knights in New Zealand last week, but while his value is never underestimated by Brad Fittler, the Roosters' kingpin believes success will come from cutting off the Knights' supply line.
Ultimately, if you stop their forwards go forward, you stop a lot of the back play, so...
Similarly, the Newcastle pack is prepared to target Fittler.
We know how to mark him and... Just push up on him and make him try and make the wrong decisions.
Moved to 5/8 to partner Johns, Kurt Gidley has simplified the Knights' game plan to contain the ultra-impressive Roosters.
Right across the park, they're dangerous, but, we've just got to sort of match their defence and just hold on to the ball and hopefully we can come away with a win.
Starting the season against the two grand finalists gives Michael Hagan a solid gauge on his team's strength.
You know, a lot's been said about the Roosters and their forward pack, so I guess our boys are looking forward to it and... it'll be a fair challenge to see how we're travelling after last week.
All teams lift against the Premiers and the Sydney boys are ready to respond.
I think they're going to be thinking about us the whole week, so it's going to be a good, tough battle.
Charles Christian, National 9 News.
Plenty to talk about coming out of the game and here's some of the reaction at the media conference afterwards.
To come up here and to do what those players did, I'm so proud of them. Not in the fact of their display of football, but in the way they just grinded away and gritted it out, showed a lot of commitment to each other. And look, I'm really, really happy for the players because the way they hung in there in this environment, they're very hostile, very loud, was a magic win.
I mean, winning games keeps you young, keeps you, you know, keeps your training tense, keeps your training positive, and that's how everybody's going. Everything's been really positive. Everyone works really hard. Everyone's hard on each other. And while you're still winning, there's always that belief.
Very happy with the effort by our blokes. Pretty young football team overall. I think probably our youngest pack in the club's history. So no complaints there. And the effort on the back of last Sunday was very good.
I just hope the judiciary doesn't get overexcited with all the hysteria that's had this week. I just hope they don't want to react because of what happened last week. Now, the blow-up in the scrum there, that it's just a part of our game. We play a contact sport. We play with aggressive people. You haven't got aggressive people who are committed. You know, you don't want them in your team.
Can I just that one little thing? Can we just add for the record, Kenny, that that's now two games under Sean Hampstead that the Roosters have won against us one? And that in both games we didn't get much at the ruck or in the 10-metre area.
Well, they're not happy about the refereeing of Sean Hampstead up there in Newcastle, and they just can't seem to find a win underneath him.
No, well, they can't, but at the end of the day, I felt as though the Roosters were just too good on the night. I know that the Knights were extremely unlucky in a couple of decisions that went against them, but in the end, I just thought the class of the Roosters and the kicking game of the Roosters to continually keep turning the Newcastle side around. Newcastle, at the end, they had no energy. They couldn't run the 70 metres, which was required, and the tactics paid off for the Roosters.
On Sports Tonight, it's 11 straight for the Roosters.
Oh, it'll be a try if they pick it up. Henderson!
And on to Rugby League now. Defending champions, the Sydney Roosters maintained their tag as the team to beat this season after defeating fellow heavyweights Newcastle at Energy Australia Stadium last night. The Roosters scored two tries to the Knights' one for a 14-10 victory, but they have Adrian Morley and Michael Crocker on report. Newcastle were this morning shaking off the loss.
The Knights up this morning, but down after last night, losing a match full of intensity, yet lacking finesse. The home side slipping up on several occasions, but so too did the Roosters, hence the low scoreline.
We turned the ball over way too much. Our completion rate was a disgrace.
Errors frustrating both sides, and it showed midway through the second half.
Two-man overlap. Now they come up and they start exchanging. Morley and Perry, left and right before they go to ground.
NRL Chief Executive David Gallop this morning not commenting directly on last night's blow-up in the wake of last week's Gordon Tallis attack.
Early in the week, sure, we indicated that we thought that matter should have gone through to the tribunal, but you know, we don't get involved in speculating on judiciary prior to what happens on Mondays and Tuesdays.
A concern for Roosters coach Ricky Stewart, Michael Croker on report for what appeared to be an elbow to the head of Andrew Johns, and Adrian Morley for a high tackle on Robbie O'Davis. And Stewart fears a knee-jerk reaction following the Tallis issue may occur.
I just hope the judiciary doesn't get overexcited with all the hysteria that's had this week. I just hope they don't want to react because of what happened last week.
Well, aside from the fisticuffs, the NRL couldn't be happier with the start to season 2003. The football has been fierce and the crowds are coming to see it.
I mean, you've got to hand it to the players. They got a 30-week season possibly ahead of them, but they've come out so far and just gone hell for leather, and I think we've all enjoyed the intensity of the football.
All right, the footy is on tomorrow night, a big game. Parramatta, of course, at home to the Knights. Para batting none from two, the Knights one from two. And it should be a great game, of course. Nathan Carless back in, Shane Dunley is in the side as well. A couple of players out there. And for the Knights, Tahu is out and Hall comes in to make his debut. I tipped the Eels. I thought they played pretty well last week, even though they went down.
I think it's going to be a hard game. The Knights, Parramatta Stadium has never been a happy hunting ground. It's always been difficult. And I reckon that the Knights still look like they're one or two weeks away from their peak. So, you know,
I think... You've only won once there in 13 years, which was last year. But I tell you what, our
pack is a rookie pack. They're only average age of 22 and a half years. And the bench, all four bench players have only played four games between them first grade. So it's going to be tough. But I still reckon they've got enough momentum. They played excellent last week. I think they can carry on. Eels have got a bit of pressure though, Sterling, haven't they? Like they've lost the last two, but also the last two from last year as well. So it's been a while since they've had a win.
Absolutely, and haven't got a good record at home for quite a while also. And of course it is a replay of the 2001 decider. It's always been a bit of rivalry, you know, feeling between those clubs, and tomorrow night won't be any different.
It should be a great game tomorrow night.
And sport is next for Tim Webster and another NRL blockbuster.
Oh, it's a beauty, yeah. The winless Eels face the might of the Knights. We'll cross live for our preview shortly. Well, a desperate Eels will be chasing their first win of the season when they face a young Newcastle side tonight, the new look Parramatta Stadium. Tony Peters joins us. This ground's got a bit of a boutique look about it now.
Certainly has, Tim. The hill areas to the north and to the south, basically the area we're at the moment now, have been replaced by seating. So the capacity at the ground has been reduced from 26,000 to 20,000, but fans are sitting here in comfort. Of course, a big game here for Parramatta tonight. They've lost two in a row. They can't afford to drop tonight because they face the Bulldogs next week.
Yeah, ground looks good. Any changes to the sides?
Yes, there are changes. The Newcastle Knights have lost winger Tamana Tahu. He's replaced by Craig Hall, a young rookie. Another rookie, Andrew Price, comes onto the bench for Hall. So the average age of the Newcastle pack, Tim, is just 22. Now, Parramatta have got changes as well. Suspended forward Steve Crouch is out. He's replaced by Lee Hopkins. Andrew Meads comes onto the bench for him. And another blow for Parramatta, I've just heard a moment ago, Brett Hodgson is unlikely to play. Luke Burt will move to fullback and Pat Richards will come onto the wing. And our referee here tonight will be Bill Harrigan, who of course sin-binned three Parramatta players in this match-up in Newcastle last year.
Yeah, now Parramatta hooker John Morris faces his old club.
Yes, he played five seasons with the Newcastle Knights, Tim, the young utility player, but of course salary cap problems forced him out of Newcastle. Now he's playing against his mates.
Well, so it's going to be a new experience for me, but I've spoken to Jason Moody and some other players who have, you know, left the club and gone back and played against them. And, you know, they basically said you just got to get out there and play as well as you can for the footy team and sort of not worry about the pressure that the other guy's going to put on you.
Tonight at Parramatta Stadium, what's shaping up as a terrific clash, the Eels are chasing their first win in three games when they play the Knights.
After losing their opening two matches on the road, the Parramatta camp says it's too early for alarm.
We're not panicking. There's plenty of times that you lost two in a row in your career.
Dyke says the Eels have to be more committed.
Push hard for each other and gel as a team. That's something we're not doing at the moment. We're not really playing for each other and gelling well as a side.
Brett Hodgson has failed the fitness test on his knee. Luke Burt now moves to fullback with Pat Richards on the wing. Boasting an average age of just over 22, the Nipper Knights, the youngest pack since Balmain's 1983 forwards. Danny Badiris and Steve Simpson provide the experience. Second rower Simpson plays his 100th game, missing just three matches since joining in 1999.
We just got to smart up a few things and take opportunities when they present themselves.
30-year-old fullback Robbie O'Davis may have discovered the fountain of youth.
Yeah, the body's feeling like I'm 21 again, and I'm getting plenty of running metres in the first couple of games, so hopefully I can continue the form that I think has been all right so far.
And after 5 years at Newcastle, John Morris has inside knowledge on his first-time clash with former teammates.
Yeah, it's going to be a weird sort of feeling. I suppose the boys are expecting me to do that, so the Newcastle boys probably change all their calls anyway.
Charles Christian, National 9 News.
Right, let's take a look now at what happened after the game. Here's some of the reaction from the coaches and the players at the media conference afterwards.
I thought we were very spirited, very determined. It was certainly a time for us to make a statement, and I think our players did it emphatically for us. And I thought Nathan and Michael Vella again, Michael picked up from the second half of last week's game. I just thought they were absolutely dominant and awesome in their, particularly in their carries, but some of the defence as well. And their teammates just got on the back of that. We were very dominant. We hit them hard early with some great carries who were very strong defensively as well. And that's what generally happens. Other blokes get on the back of spirited performances by front rowers.
They made a lot of breaks, and I think we had just about every player in our team chasing back on all the breaks that they made. So that was another sign that everyone was working together for each other.
Probably 10 to go. We were 6 points behind. And we came up with an error, ran into touch, and I don't think we saw the football after that. So They were certainly good enough to put some points on in the end. And, I think, you know, the toll on the players from the possession in the first 20 probably took its toll on the back 10, to be honest. And the effort in between times was fantastic, and couldn't thank the players enough for the work they're doing at the moment.
Season opener, at home, you want to make a statement. I think we did it. We need to make another one next week.
We've heard from Michael Hagan. Let's hear from him once again, this time talking about the penalty count early in the match, which went 7-0 against the Newcastle Knights. He admitted afterwards that both he and the players are somewhat confused about the new play the ball rules.
I'm not sure, mate. I'm a bit confused at the moment. I think that's, you know, all that needs to be said at the moment on that issue. I think the players and all the coaches are getting more confused as we progress.
Well, it's something that's been spoken about a lot in the early part of the season. Well, I think we have seen some varying degrees of application of the new rules, the way they stand.
Yeah, it's going to take a little bit of time for teams and referees alike to get the interpretation right. I think Michael Hagan would have been frustrated in the penalty count being 7-0 and believing that his team was the only team out there getting penalised. And some of the incidents that did occur, he probably had every right to complain, because I feel as though Parramatta probably got away with a little bit. But having said that, similar result last year in that game where Parramatta had four blokes sin-binned in that game. But again, I thought that Parramatta, their experienced blokes, got them home when it was counted.
In rugby league, Parramatta counting the cost of injuries after beating the Knights. Newcastle were just counting the penalties.
And now we've got penalty number six. Can you believe this?
Well, inconsistency was the buzzword coming out of last night's NRL match between Parramatta and Newcastle, but it wasn't so much the players coming under fire, but the referees and how they enforced the rules. Bill Harrigan was the man in the middle as the Eels posted their first win of the season, 30-12. The man of the match was John Morris, a former Knight starring for Parramatta.
Parramatta on the winners list in 2003 following a gutsy and credible 5-2 win against the Knights.
It was certainly a time for us to make a statement, and I think our players did it emphatically for us.
Last year a Knight, now an Eel, and still superb, but man of the match John Morris not as quick with the tongue on the field as he is his feet.
You haven't got really time to sort of be telling your teammates what sort of plays they're calling, and you know, I couldn't really give them any tip-offs.
Parramatta's win not sealed until the dying stages, and summed up with one defensive play.
10 minutes to go, it's a 6-point ball game. Kurt Gidley makes a break down the sideline. Three of your guys hammered him. It showed the sort of spirit that you played with tonight.
Yeah, for sure. You know, we've probably been playing with spirit all year. You know, we're a close bunch of guys, but we just weren't doing those little things on the field, you know, that's when it matters, I suppose.
The Knights were pumped with 7 straight penalties to start last night's match, and they're mystified as to the different rule interpretations from game to game.
I think the players and all the coaches are getting more confused as we progress.
I'm very aware of who I need to speak to about the referee's performance.
Eels fullback Luke Burt fractured his collarbone and will be out for 4 to 6 weeks. And the Knights' injury toll rises. Matthew Jobson and Joshua Smith expected to be sidelined for lengthy periods.
Last night, referee Bill Harrigan put in another controversial display in an Eels-Knights clash. Last year, para players were sin-binned 4 times in a game against Newcastle. This time, the Knights were penalised 7-0 in the opening 20 minutes.
You've got to let him go, so you pushed him over a little bit more to turtle him or whatever. No more.
Harrigan's interpretation of the play the ball had the Knights fuming, but Coach Hagan was doing his best to avoid a $10,000 fine.
No, I don't think we were that bad in the first 20 at the ruck, but it was perceived that we were. I think the players and all the coaches are getting more confused as we progress.
As for the footy, the Eels made the most of the early dominance in possession and by half-time led 18-6.
Dykes, here comes a foot race. Dykes is away for Parramatta. He's stumbling, but he gets there.
The Knights did get back to within 6 points before the Eels ran in some late tries to finish 30-12 victors for their first win of the year.
It was certainly a time for us to make a statement, and I think our players did it emphatically for us.
But it wasn't all good news for Parramatta. Winger Luke Burt is out for 6 weeks with a shoulder injury. Bernard Cohen, 7 News.
Well, I mentioned earlier, of course, that Parramatta got the first 7 penalties. Let's have a listen now and listen to Bill Harrigan give those first 7 penalties.
All Avery, too long. All right, I'll explain that one to you. You hear me call dominant. So if they surrender tackle, I'll call dominant, you get the extra little bit. That's got nothing to do with what the penalty was for then. That was just throwing him away. That's wasting time. You were off the ground. The bloke was standing up and you flung him down. I'm not debating it. I'm not arguing it. Two, Matthew, let go. Okay. He was dominant then.
Okay.
He beat you through the mark with your impact.
Yep.
You got to let him go. So you pushed him over a little bit more to turtle him or whatever. No more. No, I can't keep warning. No. Interference at the play of the ball.
I'm going to go, mate.
So a dusty start there for Newcastle, and you could see the looks almost of amusement on some of the Knights' faces at times.
Yeah, I mean, I think that the referee's probably come in for more criticism than he deserves, because a lot of the penalties were actually different.
Absolutely.
One, the touch judge ran on to give a penalty, and I think Newcastle were really threatened by the pace of the game and were trying to slow it down. When Parramatta are on a roll like that and they're getting out of dummy half quickly and their forwards have got footwork, you can be drawn into giving away penalties. And it's not as though all penalties were the same. Bill Harrigan didn't target one particular area, and I think this is an ongoing campaign by a number of coaches in the league and a number of people in the media who are unhappy with the current spate of defence being dominant in games. They're reluctant to change their style of attack to accommodate. And this is where Robert Finch, the referee's boss, has really got to sort the wheat out from the chaff and say, well, you know, he's doing a good job, the referee. And I thought the referee did do a good job on Friday night.
I suppose the thing is that, coincidentally, this comes on top of the two sides winning last year, of course, where we saw four Parramatta players sent to the sin bin in the one game. What it does do is basically tell you that if Bill Harrigan is going to referee your football team, and here is vision of Parramatta being on the wrong end of the penalty count last season, if Bill Harrigan is going to referee your game, you've got to make sure you play the ball area is an area that you're very clean in. You do everything right. 60% of his penalties last season were for play the ball infringements, and he's strong in that area, so you don't take him on.
I'll tell you this, Peter, another thing about Bill Harrigan is you're not going to wear him down.
Exactly.
Some referees might give a couple of penalties and say, well, I can't tolerate. He will keep going and keep going. He'll put two, three in the bin. He doesn't care. He's not going to be stood over himself, and that's the respect that Bill Harrigan's built up over a long period of time.
I think a big difference for the players is the referees, something that they referee differently, and
very,
consistency with referees is something that we've got to get into our game. That way the players can understand which way the referees interpret, you know, the certain rules. So that's one thing I think we can improve on.
I mean, you're the most recent player here on this panel. The speed of the game, I mean, do you think it got too quick there for a while, and do you think it's coming back to a more even keel?
Yeah, but it's still very frightening for me, I think, that, you know, the game, even I've retired 2 years ago now, and the speed of the game today, as I said earlier, is just fantastic, and it's hard for the referees to keep up with the game. It's going to be even harder for the players to stay with it as well, so something's got to give.
But what about coaching yourself? I mean, you're a half 5'8 and a great one.
And a future Broncos first grade coach.
Yeah. In coaching young players today, do you find a huge difference in the game and the needs of a player to play at the top level?
Yeah, most definitely. You know, when I was playing, we never did much work on play the balls or ruck work. But these days, you know, half your time is spent trying to slow the play the ball down, wrestling, all that sort of stuff. We've got a wrestling coach at the Broncos. I mean, what do they got to do with football?
Mario Milano.
Mario Milano. Sorry,
Larry O'Day.
He does look like him, though.
Geez, when I played, all I needed was a bowl of Cocoa Pops. That's what I played on some of the best. All right, now, Andrew Johns, we caught up with him after the game as well.
You know, you get those sort of games when you don't dominate the tackle, and I think the ruck now is such a vital area of the game that you know, it's a massive, you know, some massive calls there. I think it was our fault we weren't dominant enough, so I thought the penalties were quite fair.
Yeah, there's Joey's comments after the game, and he was outstanding again on Friday night. If he doesn't play, Newcastle get lapped by 40.
Well, I think the great thing from Parramatta's point of view was their performance enabled them to negate his kicking game. I think it probably took maybe half an hour before we actually saw him come up with an attacking kick on the opponent's line. And if you can do that, you do take away a fair bit of the armoury from this Newcastle team.
All right, so a good one there to Parramatta. The Parramatta fans were happy on Friday night as they left the ground, and good on you, Brian Smith.
Now, the injuries out of round three so far in the Telstra Premiership. Big toll from Friday night for Parramatta Luke Burt. Confirmation, he has a broken collarbone. He is looking at 6 to 8 weeks on the sidelines. On the positive front, Brett Hodgson will be back available from a knee injury for next Friday night's match against the Bulldogs. On the Newcastle side of things, young forward Matt Jobson, a fractured eye socket. Joshua Smith, their winger, has a knee ligament damage. And catching up with one of their injured troops in the dressing room after the game, Matt Parsons, been reports he'd be back in a fortnight from a back injury. The latest medical advice that Matt has is he was out for another 5 weeks. Now, finally, this morning on Around the Grounds, we have our dressing room plenty to talk about after Friday night's match between Newcastle and Parramatta. Sick and sore, some of the Knights boys.
Adam, 27 tackles for you, 14 hit-ups tonight, and a sign that there's a lot more work to come with the injury, Tom.
Yeah, well, that's right. A few injuries again tonight.
it's not going our way at the moment, but you know, the best thing about rugby league is we've got another week to go to prepare for Melbourne, and we're going to use that to our advantage and, you know, come out next week all firing.
Well, Craig, what did you make of that 80 minutes tonight? Your first 80 minutes in first grade, and I've got to say adventurous is the word that comes to mind.
It's quick. That's just quick and hard. It's just, I think we struggled a bit in that first half, which put a bit of pressure on ourselves, but when you got guys like Joey Johns and Sean Rudder and inside you, it makes you feel a bit more confident. So seeing, having them out there definitely helps you, definitely makes you feel a bit more safe out there.
Tough night for Newcastle, but a night that Todd Bates will remember. First try in first grade against the club where you spent the last 3 years.
Yeah, for sure. It was good to get a try, especially in my second game. It would have been good to get one last week, but yeah, it was just good to get over the line today, and especially against those boys, they were heckling me a bit out there, so it was good to get a try.
You know, you just can't put the white flag up and say we've got too many blokes out injured. You know, most of these guys are going to get their opportunity this year. Throughout the year, you play with probably a squad of 28 to play the whole year. Unfortunately, we have to fast track a few blokes and give them a shot, but it's all about, you know, nursing them through and being as positive as possible. You know, we'll aim up next Saturday. It's a big one at home, and it's a must win, I suppose.
Now listen, we're about to hear from Reg Reagan, but Reg has copped a bit of a spank. Now, his mother, Rose Reagan.
Yeah, Reagan.
Rose Reagan.
Yeah.
Had a chat to Reg and said, Reg, I want you to cut out all the swearing.
Yeah. Well, I had a yarn to Reg myself. He's been a little bit blue, as you know.
He has.
Getting under people's noses, particularly mothers and young children. But I've sent him to anger management classes. And look, guys, it's the 80s show, okay?
It is.
And he loves his mum. He loves
Rose.
We all do.
And he loves his dad, Ronald, too, Ronald Reagan. But also, he promised me, he said he'd be good if we just send him out to the streets again, all to right. A street talk of Parramatta Mall.
Look,
this is what
mouth.
He's come up with.
Yeah. Here's Reg Reagan out in the streets talking about the 80s.
You're simply the best. Nah, nah. Better than all the rest. Nah, nah. G'day, I'm Reg Reagan, and I can't tell you how stoked I am this week. I haven't been this stoked since Bob Hawke gave everyone a day off back in 83 after that big boat race. The Doggies are playing the Eels on Friday night, and finally, everyone's talking about the old days, the good old 80s. So let's go and see what the people in the streets remember about those great old days. What do you remember about the 80s?
Not too much.
Yeah, well, look at you. You'd remember what happened yesterday, would you?
Not at all.
Who were some of your favourite Parramatta players? What about Nude Nut Sterling? You like him?
Yeah, he was my favourite, especially with the ball.
What's your favourite song from the 80s?
My favourite song from the 80s... Any song is all right.
Any song? What about Ghostbusters? Do you like that song?
Yeah,
that's nice. We sing it?
Ba-da-ba-ba-na-ba-na-ba-na-ba-na-ba-na-ba-na-ba-na-ba-na-ba-na-ba-na.
He ain't afraid of no ghost. Ba-ba-ba-ba-ba. It's fun to stay at the YMCA. It's fun to stay at the YMCA. What does your old man say about the 80s?
He was too blind drunk to remember.
Nothing wrong with that, mate. Hey?
I don't know what happened in 1980s, man.
Too much of the good stuff?
I forgot totally, man.
Oh, that's an 80s song.
Wake up before you go, guys.
Eye of the Tiger, I don't
know. Eye of the Tiger, can we sing it together? Yeah. It's the eye of the tiger, it's a thrill at the fight. Rising up through the sun and rising. And the for survival, once he's praying the night, and his words in the burning the
eye of the tiger.
I tell you what, guys, I'd give anything to see Goldilocks Sterling and Little Turvey the Terrier Mortimer going at it again at the scrum base. And if you ask me, there'll never be another decade like the 80s. They were simply the best.
But when you see Reg, could you pass on our congratulations to him? I thought he handled that pretty well.
Not one swear word.
And
guys, how good were the 80s? What about, like, tell us, how did you dress to go to the discos in the 80s?
The long blue flares.
Yes.
And the body shirts.
How good did you?
I had a body then.
Did you?
I thought the 80s were good until I heard Reg starting to sing some of the songs from the 80s, and it wasn't that good, really, was it?
How good was Ghostbusters?
Oh, God. Who you got a call?
Well, here in Newcastle, of course, they know plenty about crowds. They always pack it out here at Energy Australia Stadium. One player, though, they won't be seeing going round this afternoon is the second rower, Ben Kennedy, who's out once again with a wrist injury. But I'm happy to say he joins us on Super Saturday. And Ken, it must be disappointing not to be able to get back out there and be on this in this side to take on the Melbourne Storm this afternoon.
Yeah, it certainly is, mate. It's certainly frustrating with the old hand. It feels great. I've trained fully with it for the last 2 weeks, so I just can't get a clearance off the bloody doctor, mate. So I'm unfortunately sitting in the grandstands watching the game.
Yeah, Ben, Michael Hagan said when we spoke to him earlier that you wanted to play, but the doctor wouldn't clear you.
Yeah, mate, that's exactly what happened. I went in 2 weeks ago to ask him. He said that was ridiculous. So I went in again last week to hopefully talk him into it, but he said no way in the world. So I'll definitely be back next week, mate.
Especially so, good to see you back on deck, and I'm sure Michael Hagan would love to have you back there, given the form in recent times, I suppose. With so many youngsters in the side, it's been hard to get much of a combination out there, and I think that showed last week against the Parramatta Eels on Friday night.
Yeah, we were a very young side last week, mate, and to be honest with you, we were probably a little bit soft at the start there, and they really put us away, and we couldn't claw our way back in. So hopefully the boys have learnt from that, and they'll start a lot tougher this week.
And how's Andrew this week, Ben? We watched him on TV last week show a few frustrations out there on the field. Has he settled down, I suppose, a little bit this week and ready for a big performance?
Yeah, no, mate, he's sweet, Joe. You know, he just plays with his heart and his chest, mate, and he's just an emotional guy, and you always know what he's like. You know, we cop that every week, and it's just a part of Joey, and it's no problems.
Of course, he has been carrying probably an ongoing groin injury now for some time. How's that shaping up? Do you get any indication he's 100% fit at the moment?
Yeah, well, as far as I know, mate, he's been turning up to train every week, and he hasn't been whinging too much, so I think he's 100% fit.
And Ben, what about the ball handling of the team? We've come to know the Newcastle Knights to be the entertainers of the competition and, you know, very good with their skills, but the last couple of weeks, the ball handling has let you down on occasions?
Yeah, it certainly has too. It has, you know, I guess with the younger blokes, and we do tend to get a little bit carried away. Certainly won't be able to do that tonight with these conditions. It's, the weather's been bad over the last couple of days. We're training in the wet, so the boys know what will be required for tonight.
Ben, of course, you played in the first Origin game last year in that Telstra Stadium big win against Queensland in game one of the series, and then missed the next two games with injury. I'm sure Origin, seeing their naming a 30-man squad on Monday, you're sort of starting to come into the back of your mind?
No, not really, mate. I'll just you know, try and get back and play the games and hopefully get picked, and we'll see what happens from there.
It was some sort of performance in that first game. I suppose you're talking about frustration, not being able to get on the field this year with Newcastle so far. That must have been very frustrating last year, watching the side go around in the second and third game, the way things panned out.
Yeah, certainly, mate. Well, you know, New South Welshmen don't like it being beat by Queensland, and unfortunately I had to sit back and watch that and wasn't able to help. So, yeah, it's very frustrating.
And while it is frustrating times for the Newcastle Knights as far as injuries concerned, you do get Matt Parsons back today, so that's a tremendous bonus.
Yeah, it is. It is, but unfortunately we lost Steve Simpson, who's probably one of our better go forward men, and in these conditions we need that. So Parso's lacking a little bit of fitness at the moment, so he'll be on for spits and spats through the game, and Simo will be a great loss for us.
And also Mark Hughes makes a return to first grade from a serious knee injury last year, so that's another bonus for the club.
It certainly is, mate. He's just a great bloke to have around a training, and he lifts everyone's spirits, and he's such a great bloke, and you know, it's great, fantastic to see him back playing.
With Steve Simpson out of the side, Kurt Gidley will now move to 5-8, Ben, and of course Daniel Abraham will fill that spot with Sean Rudder going to the lock forward position. Kurt Gidley is an exciting young player, isn't he?
Yeah, mate, and he's really come on. Joey's done a lot of work with him this year, and he's really impressed me with his mental attitude and his physical training, and I think he's going to be a real player of the future.
And what are the guys focused on for today's game, Ben? What one area do they believe that they need to win the actual game?
I think, like you said, boys, I think, you know, we've dropped a lot of ball. So I think we've got to hold the pill and be a little bit more physical.
Well, Ben, good luck, and hopefully we'll see you back on the paddock pretty soon, and we'll see what happens in this game between the Knights and the Storm. But thanks for joining us on Super Saturday.
My pleasure, boys. Thanks a lot.
The injured Ben Kennedy down there, of course, here at Newcastle. And we'll come back to preview the game between the Knights and the Storm right after this. And also we'll have the toss with the captains and the referee.
Going to take a shot for goal from the halfway line. Struck it pretty well. He has! picked it! Andrew Johns, you are the Messiah!
Kick by Andrew Johns here at Newcastle last year. A marvellous kick from halfway. You don't see too many potted from halfway these days, do you?
You don't, and especially the way that he lined it up. It wasn't conventional. He had it tilted there towards the side. He struck it beautifully, and he had the wind in his face. It was a magic kick. We were lucky enough to be here on that occasion. He's a fantastic player, and he's got it all.
Of course, we're building up to this clash this afternoon between the Knights and the Storm, our first live game today on Super Saturday. Let's take a look now at the missing Knights, because there are plenty of them who aren't able to be included. Of course, we've just spoken to Ben Kennedy. Steve Simpson obviously is out, and Adam McDougall, of course, still perhaps 4 weeks away.
Yeah, three Australian players out: Kennedy, Simpson, McDougall. Clint Newton has been a good bench player for the Knights over the years, and Anthony Quinn got his start last year on the wing, and Josh Smith, only a rookie, but all those players will be missed, especially when they're playing the best sides in the competition. Last weekend, they struggled against Parramatta. It'll be interesting to see how they go tonight against this Melbourne Storm outfit, who are on top of the competition.
Of course, one veteran they do have in action tonight is Robbie O'Davis, the fullback, and one-time Queensland fullback, has started the season in outstanding form. We can swear he's turned the clock back 10 years here.
Yeah, played State of Origin again last year on the Bing and Sting, but he is an exciting player, Robbie O'Davis. Every time he gets the football, he tries to catch it on the full. He returns the ball up the field. He knows who to run off. I think that's a key for Robbie O'Davis. He will sniff around the people that he believes can offload the football. He's safe, he's always good under pressure, and he's an exciting player. And he's a guy that always chases through on the Andrew Johns kicks.
Well, let's hear from his coach now. Michael Hagan is standing by with Tim Wharton.
Call Matt Parsons. He's due back. Big boost for you guys.
Yeah, it is probably an unexpected bonus for us this late part in the week, but I'm very happy for him to get back on the park, and we're probably missing him a little bit at the moment.
Unfortunately, though, Steve Simpson looks like he's out.
Yeah, Steve Simpson played his 100th game last weekend, and he hasn't missed too many, and he's succumbed to probably a hip flexor injury, which should only keep him out a week, we hope, and should be back for Canterbury next Friday night.
Ben Kennedy, how tempted were you to bring him back?
Oh, I think we're always tempted to use Ben Kennedy, but medically he was always needing a clearance, and the specialist wouldn't grant him one, so he's not all that happy at the moment, and probably neither are we, but we should get him back next week as well.
And nice to be back home after that frustrating loss to Parramatta.
Yeah, it is. I mean, we enjoy playing here, and I think the players, you know, looking forward to getting a few things sorted out, and we're not far away, I think, but we've just got to tidy up a couple of things, and I think the players always enjoy playing here at Energy Australia Stadium.
Good luck today.
Thank you.
They certainly enjoy playing here with a big crowd behind them. And here's their side for tonight's game. Mark Hughes has been brought back into the side, so straight from the bench and into the run-on team with a reshuffle now, a forward pack, also with Matt Parsons coming into the team.
Yeah, still a strong lineup when you can have six State of Origin players. You've got O'Davis, Tahu, Gidley and Hughes that have all played State of Origin fullback in the outside backs. Johns and, of course, Denny Badiris. Josh Perry's probably a key tonight. He needs to continually do what he's been doing the last couple of games. Probably needs to play a little bit longer in patches, because he's the most experienced front rower, although Parsons is coming back, but he's a bit light on for match fitness, so Perry needs to step up to the plate a little bit more today.
Time now for the toss. Let's go back downstairs. Our referee is Shane Hain, and he's with the captains, Steve Kearney, and also Andrew Johns.
Andrew, to the home side. You toss. Steve, your call.
Yeah.
That's a tail, mate. That way?
Yeah.
You guys are kicking off that way, okay? Best of luck.
Andrew, want to come back after that frustrating loss against Parramatta last week?
Yeah, it's a bit unusual to be only one from three at the start of the year, so we've still got some personnel out. Obviously, Ben Kennedy and Steve Simpson will be, they're hard to replace, but it's a really important game we win tonight.
Positive note, you've got Matt Parsons back.
Yeah, we just need his go forward there a little bit, and he's got a big presence about him. He's a big guy, and he's been missed, but just got to make sure we really get forward, support him, and I think what we've lacked in the past couple of weeks, our patience. We're just going to be more patient, try to get to our kick and put more pressure on.
All right, good luck tonight.
Thanks, mate.
That's the captains. They'll be out on the field in just a few moments' time as the Knights take on the Storm here in Newcastle.
That's it from me after the break. The Knights up against the Storm.
Now, Vossie, do you think you can handle one of those?
You're kidding. I think I'd need a rib reconstruction after a Ruben Wiki hit like that. Got another big hit right now, one of the biggest from 1997 in our Boots and All Classic Collection. We had lead commentator Terry Kennedy recap this hit on Craig Field.
Nines, Kosev. Oh! Massive hit! That's the biggest hit of the season so far.
And it's Mark Ramble too that comes up with that hit. That is a sensation! Look at this! He nearly puts him back to Wollongong!
From memory, it wasn't a great pass, and poor old Craig Field had exposed his ribs, and just a big target came up there for Glanville. He timed it to perfection. I think that was the thing. He hit him. He hit him hard, drove him back about 5 metres, it seemed like that. The air that came out of Craig Field's lungs, I thought a big southerly buster had hit Brookvale. And the crowd, they roared, we roared with him. To his credit though, Craig Field, you know, the ribs went back through the spleen. He was down for a while, but he got back up.
Oh! Massive hit!
We'll have more Boots and All after the break.
Put off the ground to get the Harrigans Chestnell Goldthorpe. And now Grogan, he's lost his jumper. Wrapped up in the tackle. 35 metres out from the St George line, and Grogan will get regressed before he plays it. He's going to find the ball for this.
There's a ball there somewhere.
Well, Danny Medeiros was a certainty to be named in the New South Wales squad this morning, and his combination with Andrew Johns was too much for the Melbourne Storm in the first half on Saturday night up there in Newcastle as they racked up a scoreline. At one stage, it got to 44 points to nil before the Storm came back with a rush of tries as they can.
Yeah, Andrew Johns again was fantastic for the Newcastle side, but I've got to say they have been missing Matt Parsons in the first couple of weeks. He was outstanding. When he takes the ball forward, he just provides that good go forward. He's also got an offload to provide a bit of second phase play, and the way they were playing on Saturday, the big lateral game, the long passes from Johns, it's pretty to watch.
And of course, the New South Wales coach had made mention of the New South Wales halfback in a column on Sunday morning. It might have inspired Andrew Johns, perhaps a couple of phone calls during the week, because he had a great kicking game and he peppered Marcus Bye with some high balls, didn't he?
Yeah, look, he's got everything, Joey, and we know how good a player he is, and he brought it all out on Saturday night against the Storm. Look, 44-0, the Storm did score some late tries, but Newcastle won the game. They totally outplayed Melbourne when it mattered. And as Laurie said, they have been doing it tough for injuries, the Knights, but it was great to see Parsons, Tahu and Mark Hughes make a comeback for them.
One thing about Newcastle, even though they do get a lot of injury problems, is the depth and the young fellows that they produce. Every season they will produce one or two young guys.
They're like the Broncos.
Yeah, they just come through.
Well, they have enormous. To, you know, because they haven't bought a player for the last couple of seasons because of salary cap restrictions.
That's right.
And they've just got these young kids that keep coming up and stand up when, you know, when the experienced players drop out.
And they always step into the mark straight away.
Yep.
You spoke about Matt Parsons. He makes such a difference to this Newcastle side. And unlucky, as I said earlier on, not to be named in the New South Wales squad. There's still plenty of time for him to work his way into a bit of fitness and form and prove that he can be there, perhaps, for the Blues.
Yeah, he wouldn't look out of place in New South Wales jumper, Matt Parsons. Certainly got a presence about him. He's a big man. But you get back to the fact the guys that we selected all deserve to be there. You look at Michael Vella, he's another one, played last year, that's unlucky to be there, but there's still plenty of weeks before the first State of Origin, and I'm sure those guys, if they continue their form, which they've been showing over the last couple of weeks, their names will get mentioned again.
Here's what Matt Parsons had to say after the game when his comeback game from injury.
I don't think the last 20 minutes was good enough for any team, let alone us at home. I don't think that was acceptable, but we can't just dwell on the negatives over here. This first 60 minutes was very positive, and yeah, I think there's still a little bit of a numb feeling and a disappointment at that last 20, but you know, we've came in, we've got the win, and we'll go away, and we don't for 1 minute think that we're on the Bulldogs pace for next Friday night at the moment, and we've got a lot of stuff to do, a lot of work to do this week, that's for sure.
And how is that for a game next week? The Bulldogs, I'm sure, will see plenty of this man doing this, charging forward, dragging players with him, Stephen Kearney, and Robbie Kearns on his back there, not a couple of lightweights, and he was able to get away with plenty of offloads as well.
Yeah, he was fantastic on Saturday, Matt Parsons. I think he was playing down Newcastle's chances. I think there was a lot to like about Newcastle's game, especially in that first 40 minutes. And, of course, they get Simpson and Kennedy back, two of the best back rowers in the game. They'll be pumped up, don't worry about that, to take on the Bulldogs. I expect them to be playing down their chances all week, but expect a fiery performance.
Yeah, he had so much to the side, Matty Parsons, didn't he? You know, when you got young blokes Perry and Wool now packing down the front row, if you've got Matt Parsons there looking after them, it certainly helps.
Tamana Tahu might have had a bad game against the Roosters in round two, but Melbourne were reminded of just how good he is, an early in and away on Semi Tadjalala, who was showing what it is like in the big time for real this time around.
I couldn't believe that Roosters game when he dropped those footballs, because as I mentioned before, when I was involved with him in the State of Origin, he's just got terrific hands. He catches the football everywhere, as he did just then. And it was just one of those nights for him. I think he dropped the ball six or seven occasions. He didn't drop one the other night. He scored a couple of tries. The skill level was enormous. And he's a player that we will marvel over in the next few years.
Yeah, brilliant player. Look, and he has been known to make a couple of mistakes in games, and he certainly did. Last year in the State of Origin, spilled a couple of balls, but he's one of those guys that you've got to have in your side. You know, he's explosive, he's got brilliant speed, and he can take a high ball, you know, in attack and defence. He can defuse a bomb, he can take the bomb to score a try. He's got it all.
And on the weekend, defensively, he was very strong. He put on a number of good hits that just stopped the Storm runners in their tracks.
Yeah, as we saw, knocking out Semi Tadjalala across the sideline on one occasion from a Melbourne scrum win. Now, Craig Bellamy was asked about the form of boom youngster Billy Slater after the game, with one journo biting off more than he could chew when he offered the opinion that Slater perhaps has fallen back to earth.
Mate, if you want me to pull Billy Slater down from his pedestal, you know, don't. You guys put him up there. He's a young kid. He's played three first grade games. He played in a different position today than he's been playing. And I thought he was pretty good for us. You know, he came up with a couple of errors, but like I say, he's played three first grade games, and he's certainly got a future in our game. So if you want me to pull him down, I ain't going to. Come to Newcastle after they've been beaten two in a row isn't any Sunday afternoon walk, and they found that out today. But I thought Billy, you know, competed till the end. And like I say, you know, he certainly didn't lose any shine in my eyes today from what he did.
It's funny how some people see things after a game. He didn't score a try, Billy Slater, but he didn't make any mistakes that I noticed, and he put that one on there for Marcus Bye. He's a very good young player.
Oh, look, he's a star of the future, Billy Slater. I think he's a terrific young player, and there's some harsh critics out there. But look, defensively, he did have a few problems early in the game. That's where they really attacked, but it was in the middle that they're losing the battle. They were on their back foot all the time. So he was going back and the Knights were coming at them and playing up there, and the Knights were desperate on the back of two losses. They needed the victory. So it was always going to be difficult. And as Craig Bellamy said, any 19-year-old going up there in Newcastle, facing them in those circumstances, is always going to do it tough.
That's played three first grade games.
Yeah.
No, I think it's a big ask. I think, look, the question might have had to have been asked from the journalist, but
sure.
I thought it was a tough one.
What about the pass, though?
It was a good one.
Oh,
Matthew Gidley, eat your heart out.
Look, only special players can do those type of things.
All right, now, Newcastle don't often lose three games in a row, and avoiding that, Mark might have had them fired up, according to coach Michael Hagan.
You know, I think the boys were cranky about last week, given that we probably had our chances and we were a bit untidy, so you know, they certainly took that on board, and I think they realised they want to be amongst the top teams, and you've got to work hard to do that. But it also reinforces possession, mate, at the moment. If, you know, we complete our seven after half-time, made an error in the next three, and they generate points, so you can't afford to do that at this level.
They certainly can't, and it all builds up to this Friday night's game, an absolute cracker at Newcastle between the Dogs and the Knights.
Yeah, it's pretty difficult to tip a winner at this stage, depending on what sides they do come up with. Look, the Bulldogs were fantastic on Friday night, as were the Newcastle side against the Storm in that first 40.
You might get your golden point after all.
Well, I'm after one. I want to call it that.
So do I. I want to be at the first golden point game now.
Now, Phil Gould's criticism of Andrew Johns has upset quite a few people.
I think Gus is playing mind games, Tim, trying to get some early publicity for the State of Origin. Andrew Johns, best player on the field in two of the four games so far, leading the Dally M Awards. And, of course, the Bulldogs are far from happy about the timing.
Well, I don't have any criticism against him, mate. I think he's the best player in the world. So, you know, I don't think they should be cheering him up too much, because I don't want him to have a blinder against us.
Is that the feeling that's what could have been done with what Phil Gould said yesterday?
Maybe they're just trying to fire him up, so we'll see on Saturday, see what the score is.
Yeah, we will. Now, that Knights-Bulldogs game should be a cracker on Friday night.
Certainly will be. The Knights have been boosted by the return of key forwards, gun forwards, if you like, Ben Kennedy and Steve Simpson. Ben Kennedy hasn't played at all this year. He's had a broken hand. So, of course, he's a very significant return. Mark Hughes also comes back into the Newcastle sides in the centre three-quarter position. Now, the Bulldogs have no changes at this stage, Tim, but there are doubts over Travis Norton. Now, the Bulldogs won a classic game last year. You might remember El Mazri kicked that terrific conversion from the sideline in Newcastle last year, and they're gearing up for the heavyweight contest.
I think you've got to turn up against the big games like this, against Newcastle and Parramatta, the Broncos and that, because, you know, they're packed full of Origin players, you know, so if you can get it over them, you know, you're pretty much, you know, you might have a fair chance of making the side.
We're still a week or two away from our best, given that Matt Parsons and Mark Hughes haven't played a lot of football, as is the case with Ben Kennedy, so it's all looking positive for Canterbury on Friday, and looking beyond that, it certainly looks encouraging.
Newcastle's premiership charge has been dealt a blow, with State of Origin second rower Steve Simpson out for 6 weeks after undergoing groin surgery.
Bulldogs clash should be pretty special.
Yeah, be a terrific game this one. Travis Norton's dropped out of the Bulldogs side today. He's been replaced by Andrew Ryan. Now, two of the real heavyweight premiership contenders of the competition, Tim. I maintain the game they played last year was the best game of football I think we've seen for a while. 22-21 to the Dogs, with Hazem putting over that conversion right near full time. It'll be a good early guide, if nothing else.
Yeah, it's an important game. Always when you come against the top teams, it's a gauge on how you're going. But to be honest, no one will remember at the end of the year, the semi-final times, who wins here. But there's not too much at stake. But, you know, in saying that, we're going to be up for it and want to win.
All right, Reg Regan, of course, we said he's back. And here is Reg's rant, the week in review.
G'day, I'm Reg Regan, and what a week in league. Tell you what's a sad day when there's more biff off the field than on. George Pickens and Andrew Denton have been going at it like two randy rabbits, fighting over who gets to fertilise the Easter Bunny's eggs, and how good is it? These blokes are fired up, and Big Andy should accept George's challenge to a fight. As my old man Ronald used to say, punch first, ask questions later. Anyway, on the field, the Doggies took on the Eels on Friday night, and strike me, what was that loony Jason Moody doing? Brian Smith should give him a kick up the date after this effort.
Yeah, I think it should have been.
Now the chance. Oh, Bungenaar has picked up a loose one, and Bungenaar scores.
I think you'll find, Ray, that Parramatta passed it to him. This is unbelievable.
Nice one, Jason. Your life membership to the Bulldogs is in the mail.
What about that little homo Matthew Johns making his debut in the commentary box on Sunday? His start, as was expected, was very forgettable. I'll sit at home having a dozen KBs when I made an amazing discovery. This bloke Johns is a half-wit. He hadn't been in the commentary box for more than 5 minutes and he starts correcting old Golden Tonsils Ray Rabbit's warrant on his calling. Have a listen to this, you morons.
Now he goes back to the 10. Picks up Captain Courageous. He's over, Fittler.
It's Byrne, Ray.
It's Todd Byrne, I beg your pardon.
Freddie Byrne.
That's him.
Good player, Freddie Byrne.
Yeah.
Freddie Byrne. Very funny, Johns. Show a bit of respect, son.
Now, each week, we're going to give a viewer a chance to pick what's left of old Reggie's brain cells by asking me a question. The first one comes from a nice young fella called Trent Paddington. Roll the tape, dickheads.
Hey, Reggie. I just wondered if we could see that Terry Martin try last week for the Canberra Raiders against the Penny Panthers. Want to take a closer look. Thought it was a real cracker. Thanks very much, Judy. Can we catch that? Come on. Okay, do I look okay?
Yep.
Seems like a nice young lad. Let's have a look at the try. Here goes the Raiders streaking towards the line. Tyron Smith gets tackled. Hey, that's not something like you perverts. Stop it. What, Trent? I know what your game is, mate, and it's a game we never play in Cessnock, so never contact Reg's rant again. You're barred, mate. Post-try celebrations weren't around when I played for the Gunnedah Grasshoppers. Back then, when I planted down a four-pointer, I just looked up to the stand and winked at some lucky Shula. She knew she was getting my post-try celebration that night in the back of me sandman. These blokes now got more in their minds than just boofing Sheilas. Have a look at this effort.
What a way to finish this one! Bullseye, says Henry!
Fellas, try to impress the Sheilas. Do something for the girls, will ya? That's unless you want to go play for that Trent Blokes team.
I'm going to have to change my slogan from bring back the biff to bring back the boof. Speaking of biff, let's have a look at who hit who last weekend.
Here's O'Neill loading up on Walker, who's perched on the ground.
Soft, boys. Real soft. Anyway, that's the week in league. I'm Reg Reagan. Go and get stuff.
What have they got left, the big fellows?
Wait till they're set.
You're confident, Matty?
Yeah, very confident.
Matty the Buttocks. Matty the Buttocks Johns.
He's not going to reach.
Hold on, champ.
There's the chief. He's flying. He's not going to reach. That could be singularly the most pitiful beat the boys' performance I've ever seen.
Anyway,
from the chief.
There you go. There's who won?
Who did Darren and Kylie take? It's the chief again. Is that chief? Who is that? It's Matty.
Like two big Easter eggs. Yeah, well done. So,
who won?
Who's won? Oh, we got a strike. So Children's
Hospital win.
$1,000 to Children's Hospital, courtesy of Mars. Let's beat the boys this week. All right, now the Andy ads are back. This is the and the punter probe as well. The ad we've taken off.
It's going good.
My nuts are freezing. The ad we've taken off is the Foxtel cricket ad. Here we go. We'll see you soon.
Kids, mine and dad has a bowl. Great. James, deep gully. Deep. Arthur, garage door. Ivy, fence. Lance, long off. Ready, son?
Dad?
All right, Reg has been in, Maddie's in, Trent's in as well, and here he is with the Knights earlier in the season.
Okay, boys, we've got a big day today. We've got our fitness test, we've got our strength test, we've got our speed test, but first of all, we've got to get our fat test done. So we've just got to find someone who can test our fat.
Hey, fat test. Not your fat tested, I'm your man, buddy.
Okay, guys, you've obviously got great bodies. You're in safe hands here. We're just going to test all your fat.
42.5.
What are we looking for here?
We're looking for how much fat they've got.
Oh.
And how much muscle they've got, far more important.
Yeah.
Okay?
Yep.
And where they carry their fat if they carry it.
Yeah.
And what we want them is to be really lean, mean fighting machines by the beginning of the season.
I like that. That guy seemed like he was carrying his fat in all the right places, though.
Pretty good.
He was good.
Yeah.
How's he measuring up, Robin?
He's looking really good.
Sure he is.
Okay.
Sure he is. Relax. That was one of my absolute favourites. EVK. Hey, you're an old boy.
You found me.
Now listen, how things going in the camp? Everyone okay?
Yeah, good, mate. Enjoy it.
Optimism for this season?
Up the what, mate?
I heard that right.
Up the middle.
Talk about that a little bit later.
How's training going this year? You feeling good? You feeling fit?
Feeling fit, yeah. Been training for 3 months now, more than I ever have.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
What's the usual for Justin Ryder?
Oh, off season in bed.
Oh, I'm your sort of guy, let me tell you something. Yeah.
We go fast, we go hard, I back up. I got lots of stamina.
Oh. 9.6. We're going to make some guy very happy one day. Oh. This one is a little beauty. Uppity bird, meaning little. 2.4.
We're in beautiful Newcastle for the Energy Australia Surf Fest. Now there's 4 world champions here with 19 crowns between them. There's also a few Knights players. Let's go have a chat to them.
Another person can take your place.
you're a bit of a rugby league supporter. You've spent a bit of time in Australia, so you must be thrilled and tickled pink to finally meet me.
What's your name?
Mark Hughes, mate. Mark. Come on, you've read about me.
Oh, yeah. Oh, man, I follow everything you do.
Yeah. you got the odd scrapbooks and that of me?
Yeah, I got a few.
You should run off me today. I'll go right out here.
And what about, you live around the corner from Joey. Does he ever keep you up late with any late night parties or anything like that?
Well, he doesn't, but his dogs are a bit of a worry. Man, those dogs can bark.
You'll find that I can do snappy left-handers,
snappy left-handers.
In and outside of banks, and any gullies out there, I'll find them.
I think you're just a dead set goose.
Joey likes to think, I think Joey thinks he's got the ability to get out there and serve these guys, but I think this is a bit of a turn. He must realise that these are real surfers.
Yes, Joey's a social surfer. He's more of a groupie for the soccer players. He's a big soccer fan, Joey.
But I've seen you out of the waves earlier and you look pretty sharp out there.
Oh, well, you know, I don't really like talking too much about my surfing ability, but go on. And the Bulldogs will be a tough one on Friday night.
Yeah, well, yeah, we always, you know yourself, mate, that we look forward to playing the big games like that. And, yeah, I can't wait for Friday night.
It's a big weekend surf fest in Newcastle. Thanks to the Newcastle guys, especially Mark Hughes, who's back in the run-on side tomorrow night. So I hope you have a big one tomorrow against the Bulldogs.
Now, of course, the games this weekend are starting tomorrow night. What a beauty. This will be up there at Energy Australia Stadium. The Knights at home to the Bulldogs. You'll see it at 8:30 p.m. on Channel 9. Ben Kennedy back for the Knights. Great news.
I'll tell you something about Willie
Steve
Mason,
Reardon,
guys.
Good player, Steve Reardon. He's in. Travis Norton out injured.
Interesting tomorrow night, guys. Clash of the halfbacks. Andrew Johns, Brent Sherwin. Yeah. Joey's the best player in the world. Brent Sherwin's probably the next big thing. But I'm looking forward to watching Willie Mason and Ben Kennedy go to it. Willie Mason, I think, openly intimidated some of the Earls last week. And he grew
he
in confidence inside his side.
It's the best game I've seen him play. He was outstanding. Parsons was good too, his first week back.
Rugby League and the Bulldogs believe they'll have a much better idea of their status in the Premiership when they play Newcastle tonight, acknowledging they'll be punished if they relax at any stage.
If there seems a touch of Rocky Balboa about the Bulldogs' training, it's because they're braced for a heavyweight battle. And the writing's on the wall not to let Newcastle off the ropes.
We've only sort of put patches in together. We've probably played our best probably 50, 60 minutes. So folks who's been into us saying that we have to play the 80 and we can't afford to play, 60 minutes against the Knights or the Roosters because they can put 20 points on you in 10 minutes.
All eyes on Andrew Johns, especially after New South Wales coach Phil Gould criticised his form. But the man after his sky blue jumper says there's more to focus on than the Newcastle magician.
You play 13 players, so it's not one player, although he does do a lot for him. But he's a great player, and if we keep him a bit quiet, then we'll keep Newcastle quiet.
Hazem El-Masri says last year's match, won by his heart-stopping goal on the bell, has steeled him for anything that happens on the Knights' turf.
I remember last year they were just all booing me when I was trying to, get that kick, so I guess it'll be a really electrifying atmosphere and hopefully we'll go out there and play a good footy.
The Bulldogs have lost Travis Norton with a knee injury, replaced by Andrew Ryan, while Ben Kennedy's return has given Newcastle an edge.
Ben Kennedy, he provides their passion and I suppose their intimidation in the forwards. Unfortunately, we lost Steve Simpson.
Ken Sutcliffe with Sport is next, and it's being billed as one of the games of the year.
Yes, Jim, the Bulldogs and the Knights, and the Dogs are keen to make it a hat-trick in Newcastle. We preview the big match right after the break. Friday night football is shaping up as a blockbuster, the Bulldogs searching for their third straight win at Newcastle. When they played at the home of the Knights last year, they staged a classic fight back in one of the games of the season.
In a game in which forwards could dominate, Ben Kennedy's return for Newcastle makes up for the extended loss of the injured Steve Simpson.
With Ben Kennedy and Matt Parson, Josh Perry up front, I think we've got certainly enough forwards to hopefully counter O'Mealy and Price and Mason.
Admitting he's the oldest and slowest in his team, 29-year-old Matt Parsons is one game back from injury and itching for a tough battle.
It's been good to have that run last week, but the quality of the game's obviously going to pick up this week, that's for sure.
Along with the Roosters, they're the benchmark this year, the Bulldogs. So, it's going to be a great game. These are the reasons why you play footy.
Though Johns puts it in perspective.
Come September, no one remembers who wins in April, so.
But what about last July? Hazem El-Masri has fond memories of how the Bulldogs came back from 19-0.
It has got there! He has kicked!
it!
Hopefully the boys will just, you know, scrum under the post and not stress me out as much as last year, so...
It was one of those games that you want to move on from if you can.
Yet it's motivation for the Bulldogs to make it three in a row in Newcastle, but they realise Johns is once again the key.
Johns is the best player in the world and I'm sure he'll stand up and be counted on the night.
Bulldogs halves Jonathan Thurston and Brent Sherwin want to dazzle the Knights with their own kicking games.
I'll have a look in the bag and see what happens.
Charles Christian, National 9 News.
The Knights and the Bulldogs kick off round 5 of the NRL in Newcastle tonight. Dogs goal kicker Hazemel Masri has fond memories of last year's match. His sideline conversion won the game and he believes he can do it again if necessary.
I'm doing my work off the field and hopefully come, you know, match day, and if I need to get a kick like that, hopefully I'll be ready on the day and, you know, God will be there with me.
Newcastle and the Bulldogs continued their thrilling rivalry this evening at Energy Australia Stadium. It was the Knights' night this time, grinding out a 12-6 win.
A heavyweight hit out to begin round 5, and to start the match, Knights captain Andrew Johns and his side were under the pump. The Bulldogs looked to be in off the boot of Brent Sherwin, but Craig Halls had the final say.
He was going to score, except he's gone to put it down, and Craig Halls' boot was in the raid.
Hazemel Masri looked more like a Western Bulldog. Knights fullback Robbie O'Davis was dumped, and all was going to plan for Coach Folkes until O'Davis enacted revenge.
They still go the blind side. O'Davis is over! Robbie O'Davis is in!
Sherwin slipping off O'Davis, the Knights ahead 4-0, and then Ben Kennedy burst back from injury. The Knights doing the job defensively also, Matt Parsons snuffing out Sherwin's grubber before the huge prop forward again headed to the blood bin. But with 7 minutes to go until half-time, a defensive error from Knights winger Tamana Tahu saw scores level. A major mistake coming from the kickoff, Willie Mason with a forgettable knock-on.
He better stay away from these to show people, put ping pong balls in his mouth, keeps that up.
And it proved costly as Tahu touched down in the corner.
Now Johns, there's a chance, Tahu!
10-6 to Newcastle at half-time, and back from the break, Tahu was nearly in again.
He's put it out there!
And then a questionable touch judge call gave the Knights a penalty, and in the end, a 6-point victory.
The penalty kick. The flag.
2 tries to 1, though, and they went to O'Davis and Tahu for Newcastle. Willie Talau for the Dogs. Let's hear from the Knights coach, Michael Hagan.
Yeah, I just think just an outstanding, probably the best team effort I've seen, and probably one of the best club games I've ever seen. Certainly, from a coaching point of view, I'm sure most people will probably see it that way.
You know, I'm sort of happy where, you know, obviously I'd like to have been going away with 2 points, but I'm sort of happy where we're at this time. You know, it's only round 5, long way to go. And as I said, I think we have improved from our first game against Souths gradually each week.
All right, let's take you to the media conference now to hear what both the captains and the coaches said after the game.
The game was that quick, and Joey can talk about that from having played the game, but the first 20 minutes there wasn't a spell, and the intensity, you can just tell it was going to be one of those games for 80 minutes at that intensity, and there's always going to be errors come out of that, and I think the tiredness and the ball becomes greasy, and it's very hard to control, and you know, it was really a matter of who could get their head around that the best we're going to come out in front.
As Hayes said, it was lightning fast. And just physical, no team sort of would give an inch. And we just cancelled each other out in the end. I was just that happy we didn't get a golden point.
You know, I think it was 25 minutes before I got a drink of water, and that was obviously because there was no breaks, you know. I think both sides showed, you know, everyone was having a break at any chance they could get. You know, I think Bill blew time out nearly every scrum because we were packing the. And the Knights boys were just taking their time, was that fast in the game.
Probably the best team effort I've seen, and probably one of the best club games I've ever seen. Certainly from a coaching point of view, I'm sure most people will probably see it that way.
You know, I thought we played better tonight than we did last week, and you know, we won last week and we got beat tonight, so you know, it's a game of inches and bounces the ball and referees' decisions and all that sort of stuff, but you know, I thought it was probably a pretty good spectacle for the people watching.
An outstanding performance by our blokes. Absolutely top shelf. And I'm sure they'll last sleep all tonight.
The Newcastle Knights were very good, as we said, especially in defence.
Around the grounds today, we have our dressing room wrap from Friday night. Two tired band of players after the clash between the Knights and the Bulldogs, and I started off in the Knights room.
Peter Stirling remarked in commentary that the Newcastle centres tonight had done a Bulldogs on the Bulldogs centres. Did it feel like that out there? It was a real game, a mission for Matt Gidley.
It was. It was always it was something we spoke about before the game. The Bulldogs centres get highly involved in and they're a potent attacking and defensive combination. So Hughes in on you, we had to try and match the Bulldogs for us to be in the game tonight. So, yeah, hopefully we did that.
Andrew, only your third game in first grade and against one of the best packs in the competition. You enjoyed tonight?
Yeah, that's unreal. That's as good as it gets.
Can you tell us how you ended up at Newcastle? Because you are a former student of one of the top rugby league schools in Canberra, Arundale College.
Yeah, I've come from Canberra. I did a year in North Sydney Bears and then come up here. Last season was my first season here.
Now, Matt, a lot of our footy show viewers probably have bad backs. Fortnight ago, you're out for 5 weeks with a back injury. Now, the last 2 weeks, you've played two games of football. What's the secret to recovery from a back injury?
I think because I've got massive slow twitch, mate. I'm the slowest bloke in the comp, so I think I haven't got to worry about explosive movements or knocking around too much, so I'm just plugging along at the moment.
Instructions for you specifically tonight from Michael Hagan when you replace a player like Steve Simpson, who was so valuable to the team. What did Michael have to say to you?
Oh, he kept it pretty simple for me, as he always does. He just said, go out and do what I do best and try and play my role in the team. And obviously had Big Willie coming at me. I just had to try and hang on to a leg or something like that, mate.
Well, Andrew, that was a fair old contest to come into the starting lineup for the first time at the Bulldogs.
It was a bit of mixed emotions tonight. It was good to get a start, but obviously Travis Norton was out. But great game, but to come away with the loss in the end, it was a bit disappointing.
I thought it was good defence from both sides, actually. 12-6 in a game of the intensity that was there, and obviously the players, the potential of scoring, both sides I thought had the guys that could score a number of tries from any position in the field, but I think the defence held really good on both sides. It was a very quick game and very intense game, and I think the scoreline showed what sort of game it was.
As I'm not quite like last year, what did it feel like coming back to this ground where you had such a magical moment?
I know, I was pretty nervous to be honest. It was a tough game and fast game at the same time, and just towards the end, it was 12-6 and I thought, it's not going to happen again, is it? So I was just preparing myself just in case. Anyway, I was hoping for it actually, so it wasn't meant to be tonight, I guess.
It was title number two for the Newcastle Knights and their fans, but for Matt Parsons, it was premiership number one, and Matt joined us tonight. What's going on, Matt? How's things?
How are you, boys?
Very well. What's the main thing that sticks in your mind from that particular night?
I think just the occasion of the whole week. It wasn't just the game. It was the enjoyment of the whole week, the grand final breakfast and the build-up and everything. It was just a really, really enjoyable week. Draining, but enjoyable.
Was it hard approaching last season as defending premiers, knowing everybody else was aiming up to try and cut you down?
Oh, yeah, I think so. I think you get that every year. But I also think that if you're in the top four or five teams, that's going to happen to you anyway. And by the same token, it wasn't that hard to defend it to a certain degree, because we actually we were right on track towards the end of the year. We just got a lot of injuries, and that probably cost us a chance of having a real good go at it.
Speaking about your injuries, you started the year off, especially in the pre-season, with some injuries, and you've just made a comeback the last couple of weeks. Are you happy with the way your game's progressing at the moment and your match fitness?
I think it is a progressive thing, and I'm probably a little bit bigger than a lot of other people trying to play the game, so I think it'll get better over the next two or three weeks, but I'm certainly not there just yet. But I'll keep trying to get a few more minutes up and get some quality out and go from there.
What are the type of minutes that you look for when you play, Matty? Is it a certain time period? And is it same with when you cart the ball forward? Do you say to yourself before a game, well, I want to make 20 hit-ups or 200 metres this game? Or what's your sort of goals when you go out to play?
I think it's a little bit unhealthy starting to try and work out how many tackles or hit-ups you're going to have in a game. I think as long as you're there to do the job and when the ball's got to be carried forward, as long as you're round about, and Joey usually tells you where you're going and what you're doing, so I usually just put my hand up and do it from there.
Well, you spoke about your form. What about the team's form? I guess it was a bit of a litmus test against the Bulldogs on last weekend, and gee, you did well.
Yeah, we were able to grind that game out, which was enjoyable. I think the fact that we're in a challenge, and every part of that game was a challenge, and we're able to come through that. But by the same token, I think every team will tell you that they're not quite on the money just yet. Obviously, only been around 5 or 6, but we're building towards something pretty good. But by the same token, we need to back up that performance with another good one this weekend.
And your defence in that game was great. I mean, to only allow the Bulldogs to have 6 points scored against you, is that something that you really worked hard on in the off-season? You look as though your line speed is a lot quicker.
Yeah, our line speed's better, but I think the greatest part of the game for us the other night defensively was our scramble. Yeah. I think the Bulldogs did put a few dints in us and they made a few breaks, but we were able to get back and defend and not let them in for tries, so that was pretty enjoyable.
Because the previous week against Melbourne there, you got off to a 30-odd point lead and then you let them back into the game, and yeah, that would have been disappointing.
That was a strange one. I'm not sure back into the game, but we certainly laid down for the last 20 minutes and I think a few of us were a bit critical of that. I know I said that I was a bit critical about the way we lay down that game, but I think it's hard when you play them games and you're ahead by that sort of margin. The other team tries a few things, grubbers, chips, throws balls, and before you know it, you know, they get a bit of a roll on and they put a couple of tries on you. And I also think the fact that we were down a few senior blokes in that game, we never composed ourselves at that time. So we need to work on that as well.
Against the Bulldogs, it was a pretty tough game. You ended up with a fair cut on the noggin, courtesy of, was it Corey Hughes' knee, an accidental one?
Oh, I think, Josh Perry threw one of his usual bad passes out the back. No, he's thrown one out the back and I've jumped on it. And I think Corey Hughes' knee just caught me on top of the head.
Henry, give us a look. Come on, there it is. Oh, it's a fair zipper, isn't it? How many
just
in that?
A little scratch. I think there's 8 in there.
Well, is that right?
Oh, there might be only 3, but every time I tell someone, it gets more and more.
Do you collect them like Kevin Campion does? You reckon he's at 1,000 in his career?
Yeah, I'm not sure. I don't think I'm as bad as Kevin, but I'm a bit taller. I'm usually a bit harder to get to up there.
That's fair enough.
You're the biggest guy for Newcastle. The biggest man on the opposite side of the field was Willie Mason. He's been talking the talk and walking the walk, but you guys just kept him quiet. He did virtually nothing.
Yeah, I don't think it's any secret at the moment that Willie, before last week, was playing very, very good football. And I think the other night it wasn't so much that Willie played that bad. I just think he was trying very hard and things probably weren't coming off for him. And Danny Medeiros and a few of the guys got up pretty quick and sort of stopped him pretty quick defensively.
Was it a plan to keep him quiet because he can be the figurehead, the spearhead?
Oh, I don't think there's any doubts that unless you're willing to keep Stephen Price and O'Mealy and Willie quiet, you're not going to beat the Bulldogs anyway. So I think the focus is certainly on Willie, but it's certainly on the other two as well.
Matt, are you continually amazed about the amount of work that Andrew Johns gets through in his game?
Oh, yeah, there's been a lot said about Joey lately and about how he's playing and people are defending him or criticising him, whatever, but he just brings every work, it's just a high quality and I mean, he just drags you along with him. You tend to play that way yourself. And just the amount of things he can do in a game, his defence the other night was, if you sat down and watched his tackles, as we've been shown there, it was just the way he defended was just unbelievable.
Yeah, he was fantastic. But is it frustrating when he doesn't play for you? When people, in all sections of the media, and I'm one, I just can't see you winning when you don't play without him.
Yeah.
You can win, mate, but you just haven't. Well, What's the reason?
Well, we'd love to say that, you know, we're sick of hearing that, but we've shown in the last couple of years that it's right.
Yeah.
You know, technically, statistically, we've shown that it's right that we can't play without him. So whenever he's out, we really, you know, we try and try and try and we're going to keep trying, but we just need to come up with other ways of winning football games. You know, we're not going to get a 40-20 or a brilliant piece of work. We just need to grind a little bit better.
And have you worked on any parts of your game in the off-season? I know that Hagues was talking about maybe resting him if games were over and giving a younger guy an opportunity just in case he's not there during the year.
Yeah, Kurt Gidley was spending a lot of time there in the off-season, but unfortunately Kurt's hurt his ankle now. But I mean, we'll get him back when the rep stuff comes around. And And the amount of football that the rep players play these days, club and representative-wise, it'd be crazy to think that Joey's going to play every game. So he needs to have some games off, and we need to have an alternative for when he does that.
His kick chase the other night said a lot about the way he approaches the game. Late in the game, puts a kick down into the corner, puts the Bulldogs under pressure, chases it through. I mean, races through himself. That must be pretty inspiring to the team when you see something like that so late in the game.
Yeah, it is, and that just comes back to the high-quality players. But he's a guy that he doesn't let a game go by without trying to win it. I mean, he's willing to do whatever it takes to win a game of football, and he showed again the other night that that's what he does. You know, as tired as he would have been in parts of that game the other night, he's still willing to do whatever it takes.
There's only one way Joey knows how to play the game, that's at 100 miles an hour. Now, as your coach Michael Hagan said, get him out of the front line, don't let him do 30 tackles, we don't want him busted, we don't want him injured. I mean, you can't tell Joey not to do it, but as he told you guys, to shuffle him sideways, get him out of that front line.
Mate, he's a pretty cranky bloke, Joey, and he doesn't like being told what to do on a lot of occasions, so I certainly don't feel like telling him that he's got to change the way he plays and get back out of the line, because he's inspirational as well. You know, if we're a little bit tired and we're struggling and he comes up with one of his players, well, obviously we all jump in behind him and go from there.
He showed plenty of urgency on Friday night in that kick chase. I thought he was great. Look, Michael Hagan's had a lot of success with the Newcastle Knights, winning the competition and taking us to the semi-finals last year. What type of influence has he had on you personally?
I think Hagues has given me a little bit more responsibility at the club. I had Warren before Hagues got there, and I think, you know, things were okay there with Warren, but I think when Hagues came in, he basically said, well, you know, we need a few of the senior blokes to stand up and probably lead a little bit more. And in saying that, I don't think you need to go out of your way to be a leader, but you certainly need to perform consistently and perform at a good level each week. So I think consistency has been the best thing I've had with Hagues there. And he makes you feel comfortable within the team, as he does the rest of the players, and it makes it a lot easier to play.
He seems as though his demeanour is quite cool and calm.
That's right. And anyone who knows Hagues knows that that's exactly what he's like. I've seen him blow up a couple of times. I think there was a game against the Tigers 2 years ago. I think we were leading by 20 at halftime and got beaten. He was a little bit unhappy that night.
Yeah.
But he tends to hold it together pretty much most of the time. And that's the sort of people that we've got in our club too, you know, right up to Mark Sargent in charge at the top and right down through. And even the players, the culture at the place is a pretty laid-back culture. So Hagues just fits straight in.
You're telling me there's no face slapping?
Mate, I don't want an end of the face slapping tonight.
He couldn't reach it to start with. I mean, what's the difference between a couple of coaches like Warren Ryan and then Michael Hagan? Is Michael more technical? Is he, you know, talk about actual technique and tackles, or was Warren that sort of coach?
I think Warren was more technical than what Michael is. In saying that, Michael is a student of the game as well. He certainly knows how to tactically, you know, get the football team onto the park and playing well. That's obvious, but I just think that it's probably the way he makes the players feel, and he's certainly a coach that you love playing for and you love performing for, you know. So that makes him, you know, probably the most positive thing about him.
You weren't named in the 30-man New South Wales squad early last week, but there's a chance, of course, to push your claims if you can make the country city game up at Gosford in a couple of weeks' time and maybe push your cause there?
Oh, yeah, I obviously haven't given up on playing for New South Wales, but first and foremost, I'd love to get a game for country again. I got a game last year and I certainly didn't think I played anywhere near what I was capable of. I'd like sort of a chance to change things there, but we'll just have to wait and see. There's a lot of football, there's another 8 weeks to go, so I'll just hang in there and get some more time under my belt and keep trying to play some decent football.
Sure, because there is a real chance to come out and do something pretty special. I mean, Jason Ryles is still out of business at the moment. Luke Bailey, if he stays fit, I'm sure will be one of the front rowers, but there's a few spots up for grabs. You're one of the selectors.
Yeah, well, there is a few spots up for grabs, and that 30-man squad was only a preliminary squad, as Matty said. There is still 8 weeks before the first state of origin, so injuries, loss of form, those type of things will come into consideration. But the way Matthew's played in the last two games, certainly he's not out of the running.
Yeah, absolutely. All right, now it's time to take a look at some of our emails from our viewers. They've been coming up, trying to get something going, to come up with a few curly questions for Matt. Now, here's one from Philip Borg. Why do all your first grade sides say Mark Hughes is the funniest player, and when are you going to score a try for the Knights, because you haven't scored one yet? Tell us, we'll do it two parts. What about Mark Hughes first up? That's from Philip Borg.
Yeah, he's a very funny bloke, and he's always up for a laugh, and he's a life of the team, and he's got a newspaper article in Newcastle at the moment that comes out of a Friday, and it's a very funny read, and I think he's got his own group of fans that just live for that paper on Friday. And he also does some radio stuff on Wednesdays too, so he's going very, very well with the media stuff.
All right, and all the pranks are still sort of happening out there. He's the Dean Treister of Newcastle, isn't he?
Well, yeah, he's certainly the jokester of the team, yeah. If that's what Dean is at Cronulla, he's certainly that at Newcastle.
All right, now what about the try? Because you haven't scored one for the Knights. The last one you scored was for South back in 1999. It's a long time between drinks, mate.
Yes, it is, yeah. But I always explain to people that that's not my end of the park. Mine's down the other end when we've got to get out of that area. But there's too many blokes in their team that are good at scoring tries. It's not like at South we struggled along there for a little while, so you know, any time anyone got a try, it was pretty good stuff. But at Newcastle, everyone seems to do it, except for me.
Now, of course, these days, all the teams have access to the thing called the video viewer. It's the stats system. And I thought I'll do my homework and, you know, watch Matt's all hit-ups, all his tackles. You can do it, boom, 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 all in a row like that. I watched all your tackles. You've made sort of 50 so far in the comp. Nobody runs at you. You know, you've made 50 tackles, but they all try and avoid you. They look at you and you go, hang on a sec, I'll run over this way or I'll run that way.
Why wouldn't they?
Yeah. Oh, I know that, but are you conscious of that at all?
I don't know. I think if I've made 50 tackles for the year, there'd be 49 flops in there or so.
I'm certainly, I wasn't suggesting that. But
it's certainly prevalent at the flop part of the game, but not really. I don't necessarily think players in this day and age think like that. I think that they're just carrying the football and hoping to get as many yards they can in the best spot they can. So I don't think it's going to deter anyone carrying the football at me, I can tell you that, but you know, it'd be nice to get a few more people coming straight at you.
Yeah, Matty, what about the breeding ground up there in Newcastle? We always know that they produce so many good quality players, but this year in particular, there's about five or six young guys that have come through and they've just stepped up to the mark straight away. Especially your bench and like the Woolnose and Quigleys and Jobsons and Prices and your winger Hall. I mean, they're all doing a sensational job at the moment.
Yeah, they are. And I mean, we've been doing that for as long as we've been in the comp as well, 15 years or more. But we can produce them. It's hanging on to them that's a problem, mate, these days. A guy like Andrew Price, I think Pricey played five games of reserve grade last year, and you probably might have thought that he was getting thrown to the wolves this year when he came into the first grade when we had injuries, but he's performed very well. Adam Woolnade gets better and better each week. He's going to be a good player for the club. And Luke Quigley and Craig Hall, these guys. Craig Hall's a local league player from Nelson Bay who got a game, and he's going great guns.
And what about yourself, mate? How long do you see yourself continuing, and will you stay in the Premiership or you look to head to England?
No, I've got a year contract left after this year, and hopefully I can get a year after that and finish about 31, 32 years. That'll do me, and I've found a great place in life at Newcastle and great lifestyle, so I certainly won't be leaving there in a hurry.
What about this weekend, of course, you take on the Sharks. Last time you went to Toyota Park, it was pretty ugly.
Yeah, it was. The running joke in the club is that I'm part of Newcastle's history books. I was part of the biggest win for the club when I played for South. It was 60-0. And I'm part of the biggest loss for the club. I played last year against Cronulla, so I'm certainly don't want to fall into that category by the end of my career. But last year they played very good and we played very bad. And the thing with Cronulla is that they're trying very hard still. And I mean, anyone that thinks that because we've won three games and they have won a game that it's going to be one-sided game, it's certainly not going to be that on Sunday. I've seen David Peachy quoted in the paper saying if they played like that, they'd get beat by 70 or 80 on Sunday. I think Peach might be thrown off a little bit there.
It wasn't Mark Hughes who told you that stat, that you were part of the biggest win and the biggest loss?
He tends to remind me of it every induction day each year.
Matt, thanks for joining us tonight. We appreciate you coming down from Newcastle. Good luck this weekend against the Sharks.
Thanks, guys.
There he is, Matt Parsons, our special guest tonight on NRL on Fox. And when we come back from this break, we'll be joined by another one in Canberra coach, Matt Elliott.